now, the greatest radio shows of all time.
Suspense.
The Shadow Node.
Washington calling David Harding, counter-spy.
Classic radio theater.
The Great Gildersleeve.
Fibber McGee and Molly.
Dragnet. Gunsmoke.
The Lone Ranger.
Now step back into our time machine with your host, Wyatt Cox.
Good evening, friends of the Inner Sanctum.
And we have a drama today. Crime. Brian Donlevy on a dangerous assignment to North Borneo. KC crime photographer Staats Cotsworth fighting the fog. Nick Carter, master detective starring Lon Clark in The Webs of Murder. Vincent Price as the Saint and the Shipboard Mystery. And we close it all out with an episode of The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, Basil Rathbone, Nigel Bruce, and The Adventures of the Living Doll. That's all coming up on this Monday. To update you, I know the last time we got together, I told you that we were going to have a blizzard here in Ely. The blizzard missed us, but we still got 6 inches of snow, which is not difficult for us to maneuver up in the mountains of northern Nevada. It's just sometimes not as much fun as we would like. But we thank you for joining us on this Monday, 11th day of March, 71st day of the year, 295 days until we get to 2025. The first regular English language newspaper, the Daily Courant, published in London on this date in 1702. In 1779, the Army Corps of Engineers authorized by Congress. In 1824, the War Department created the Bureau of Indian Affairs in 1824. And in 1845, Henry Jones invented self-rising flour. In 1861, the Constitution of the Confederate States of America is adopted. That basically made the Civil War going on. That was 1861. The Great Blizzard of 1888 began along the eastern seaboard of the U.S., shutting down commerce, killing more than 400 people. A meteorite entered the Earth's atmosphere on this date in 1897 and exploded over New Martinsville, West Virginia. The debris caused damage, but no injuries reported. In New York City on this date in 1927, Samuel Roxy Rothfeld opened the Roxy Theater. In 1941, prior to the U.S.'s entry into World War II, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt signed the Lend-Lease Act. It allowed American-built war supplies to be shipped to the Allies on loan.
Every plane, every other instrument of war, old and new, every instrument that we can spare now, we will send overseas because that is the common sense of strategy.
A total of $50.1 billion worth of supplies were shipped. That's equivalent to $659 billion today. It was 17% of the total war expenditures of the U.S. In return, the U.S. was given leases on Army and Navy bases in Allied territory during the war. In 1942, General Douglas MacArthur abandoned Corregidor. He was wanting to fight on in the early part of the war. U.S. said, no, get out of there. And he did. 1982, New Jersey Senator Harrison A. Williams resigned from the Senate shortly before a Senate vote on his expulsion.
I do not feel that I broke any code of ethics.
Williams, convicted of bribery and conspiracy in the Abscam scandal for taking bribes in a sting operation by the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Now, the Senate Committee on Ethics recommended Williams be expelled because of his ethically repugnant conduct, but he chose to resign. 2 years later, in 1984, Democrat presidential candidates Gary Hart and Walter Mondale involved in a televised debate prior to the New York and Pennsylvania primaries, when Mondale used a hamburger restaurant slogan to refer to Hart's policies.
When I hear your new ideas, I'm reminded of that ad, "Where's the beef?"
Yeah.
Mondale would eventually win the nomination, but be destroyed by Ronald Reagan at the polls in November, winning only his home state of Minnesota. In 1985, Mikhail Gorbachev became Soviet leader. In 1993, Janet Reno, confirmed by the Senate and sworn in the next day, becoming the first female Attorney General of the U.S. Former Beatle Paul McCartney knighted on this date in 1997. In 2002, two columns of light soared skyward from Ground Zero in New York as a temporary memorial to the victims 6 months after the September 11 attacks. In 2011, Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker signed a measure to eliminate most union rights for public employees, a proposal which had provoked 3 weeks of protests. Passing away on this date in history, a lot of people. Pioneer agronomist Johnny Appleseed, Oscar Mayer, the Bavarian-born meat packer. Yes, there really was an Oscar Mayer. Admiral Richard E. Byrd, Earl Stanley Gardner, the author of many books, including the creator of Perry Mason. Television producer Philo T. Farnsworth, blues musician Sonny Terry, pro wrestler Dino Bravo, another pro wrestler, John Hill was his name, but he was known as Guy Mitchell, the Stomper, Gentleman Jerry Valiant, passing away on this date in history. Also, Vince Edwards, remember him from Ben Casey. Also, Serbian President Slobodan Milosevic, actress and singer Betty Hutton, and football player and actor Merlin Olsen. This is the birth date of the accordion aficionado, Lawrence Welk.
And now, here he is, Mr. Music Maker himself, Lawrence Welk.
Call Spotlight on our musical family. And to get things started, let's strike up the band. Paul Humphrey, take it away.
For years and years, Lawrence Welk, a tradition, I believe, Saturday nights on ABC. For many, many years, finally the show was not renewed, and it continued on into syndication, and I believe it's still used by many PBS stations to get donations from older folk. Lawrence Welk, born on this date back in just 1903. Actor Albert Salami, also born on this date. Supreme Court Justice Antonin Scalia. Buffy in The Family Affair. Anissa Jones. And Chekhov in the Star Trek reboot, Anton Yelchin, who passed away at a very young age. He was born on this date in 1989, and he passed away in 2016. All those folks born on this date in history.
Hi, this is Jeff Foxworthy. It is now time for the birthday announcements. The following people are now officially older than dirt.
Feel like I'm an infomercial. But wait, there's more. Let's see. Let's start down here. From The Walking Dead, Thora Birch is 42. From Alias and Heroes, David Anders is 43. From Good Charlotte, the band, twins Benji and Joel Madden both turned 45 today. From Empire, Terrence Howard is 55. The lady who sang about Stay, Lisa Loeb, 56. From CSI, Wallace Langham is 59. Jesse Jackson Jr., 59. Got to Be Real, Cheryl Lynn, 67. The director of Airplane and Ghost, Jerry Zucker, is 74. From Nightline, Sam Donaldson, ABC reporter, 90 today. Australian-born entrepreneur Rupert Murdoch is 93. And don't worry, be happy, because Bobby McFerrin turns 74.
Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry, be happy. In every life we have some trouble. But when you worry, you make it double. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy.
Don't worry, be happy. Bobby McFerrin, 74 years old today. Those some of the people who celebrate the 11th day of March as their birthday. And if this is your birthday...
Hi, we're the Four Freshmen, and we just want to say...
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
Crime drama today on this Monday Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. We'll check in with Brian Donlevy in a moment. Dangerous Assignment from 71 years ago, March 11th. 1953.
Know what COLORAD means? It stands for Control of Electromagnetic Radiation. Sounds pretty complicated if you're not an electronic engineer, and yet all you have to do is dial your AM radio to 640 or 1240 in the event of an enemy air attack. And thanks to COLORAD, you will continue to receive official information.
In times of civil defense emergency, for official news and civil defense instructions, dial COLORAD at 640 or 1240 on your AM standard radio.
You know, what's interesting is a lot of the things that were done in the civil defense era, a lot of the building standards and such, they actually made sense in making something that was long-lasting and would survive a long time. Go check out civildefensemuseum.com, and you'll see a lot of documents and pamphlets there that if you're considering building a home, you might want to look at it. Now, let's get to Dangerous Assignment starring Brian Donlevy. This is from 71 years ago, March 11th, 1953.
Dangerous Assignment, transcribed starring Brian Donlevy as Steve Mitchell.
Yeah, danger is my assignment. I get sent to a lot of places I can't even pronounce. They all spell the same thing, though, trouble, but... When I walk into the commissioner's office, I don't realize that this assignment's going to prove that sometimes what goes up never comes down. Morning, Commissioner. You sent for me?
Steve, I've got a ghost for you to go after.
Gentleman or a lady?
She's no lady. She's a tramp.
What?
Freighter, that is.
Oh, ghost ship, huh? Shades of the Flying Dutchman.
We believe this ship has been running supplies and war materials to the guerrilla forces in the Philippines, Steve. From some port in the South China or the Sulu Sea.
But we've never been able to catch up to her, huh?
She's been spotted time and time again. We think we have her trapped, and then she vanishes completely.
Any leads at all as to where she picks up her supplies?
One, Steve. Yesterday, North Borneo authorities discovered a large storehouse along an isolated section of the coast north of Sandakan.
Could be the base of operations for our lady ghost.
Could be. Get over there, Steve. Check with the constabulary at Sandakan and track down this ghost ship. Well, that's it. You've got your assignment. Good luck.
The National Broadcasting Company is presenting Dangerous Assignment, starring Brian Donlevy in the role of Steve Mitchell, colorful, two-fisted government agent. At all those places of the world where danger and intrigue walk hand in hand, there you will find Steve Mitchell on another Dangerous Assignment. All Hollywood will be on hand for the Academy Awards Thursday, March 19th. And you can hear a complete description of this gala presentation of the fabulous Filmland Oscar when you set your radio dial to NBC. Yes, NBC invites you to share the glamour, glitter, and swank of Academy Award night during a 90-minute broadcast of this fabulous event. Paul Douglas will do the radio commentary, and Bob Hope will be on hand to keep the proceedings running smoothly. Yes, it's Hollywood's most important night of the year, Academy Award night. So be sure to hear every star-spangled moment on Thursday, March 19th, on the NBC Radio Network.
Sure, I've got my assignment. Get over to North Borneo and get on the trail of a ghost ship which has been running supplies to guerrilla forces in the Philippines. It's early Tuesday evening when my plane sets down at Sandakan, capital of the British Crown Colony. A representative of the local law is there to greet me, and he starts hustling me to a waiting car.
Name's Jeffries. I'd appreciate it if you made it just plain Fred.
All right, just plain Fred. You can make it just plain Steve. And what's the hurry?
We're expecting our ghostly friend sometime tonight.
Oh, the ship? Where? At the spot where you located the storehouse?
Right.
What makes you think she'll show tonight?
Well, a patrol boat picked up a fisherman off Batu Island. His boat was shot out of the water by the ghost last night.
What?
Yeah, six men aboard. Skipper, the only survivor. Man named Dubeck. Patrol boat wasn't far away when it happened. Heard the explosion when the shell hit. They picked up Dubeck, swept the area thoroughly, and no sign of the ghost ship.
Where'd you say this happened?
Off Batu Island. Oh, quite a way up the coast.
And the ghost is probably headed this way to pick up that stuff at the storehouse, huh?
Oh, it's a distinct possibility. All things considered, she'll be due at the spot in another hour or so. Here we are, Steve.
After you.
Thanks.
Any particular reason why the ghost would want to sink the fishing boat?
Oh, might have mistaken her for the patrol boat. There was quite a fog, you know.
Was the fisher equipped with a radio?
Right. But many of them are equipped with radio. That's the reason, I think. The ghost rammed three other fishers in the past month.
Yeah. She probably likes privacy. Doesn't want anyone around to report her position. Do we have any description of her?
Other than that she's a freighter? None. But before the night's over, we might know a lot more about our friend the ghost. I hope.
Later, we pull up at a spot along the coast. There's a bright moon overhead, but it's not much help since a low, heavy fog clings to the area. Jeffries and I make our way through the trees and step out onto the beach.
Over here is the road leading from the dock. It goes back into the jungle to the storehouse. It used to be an old ammunition dump. Like to have a look?
Yeah. Never did like that sound. Nine times out of ten, the bird turned out to be a Japanese soldier.
Well, this time, it happened to be one of my own men. Got him scattered all over the area. Another one of my chaps, Joe Tiber. Never could do that call properly.
Sounds good enough to me.
Oh, wait till you hear Sam Keone. He's a top man in the bird call department. Does tend to be a little flashy at times. Overconfidence, you know. Here we are. Down this way. Climb the steps. I'll turn on my torch.
Hey, quite a layout. All steel and concrete.
Stops over there in the crates. Guns and ammo on this side, and over here various kinds of machinery. Auto, parts, chemicals, fuel, so on.
Yeah, so I see.
If you're looking for a trademark or serial number on that stuff, don't bother. It's been filed off.
Yeah, I can see that too. Still, there must be something we...
Hold on, Steve.
What?
Listen.
What is it?
It's a signal from my chaps. They've spotted something.
Come on.
This way, Steve. Down to the beach.
You saw. Here.
What is it, Keone?
Over that way, sir. That way, past the dock. It was there a moment ago, sir.
A ship?
The fog seemed to leave. Yes, sir. It looked like a ship.
I don't see anything now. Are you sure you...
Hold on, Steve. Listen. You hear anything? No. Guess just my imagination.
What you saw out there, Keone, it might have been just another bank of fog moving in. In this light, your eyes are bound to play crazy tricks.
They're possible, son.
Well, might as well make ourselves comfortable, Steve. Sit down.
Got the night ahead of us.
Two pots of coffee and half a pack of cigarettes later, the sun is high overhead and the fog is completely gone. There's no sign of the ship. Just to play it safe, Jeffries leaves his men on the scene and the two of us head back to Sandycan. We spend the rest of the day nosing around the waterfront. We pick up a lot of talk about the ghost, nothing more. Early that evening, before heading up the coast again, we decide to stop in at the local hospital to have a chat with a fisherman who survived the shellfire from the ghost ship.
Rick's room is down this way, Steve. Doctor said he'd be...
Jeffries!
Leon Maris, he owns a fishing fleet, one of the largest in the area.
Jeffries, I've been waiting for you.
I figured that. Look, I'm sorry about what happened.
Of course. That's what you said the last time and the time before and the time before that. How long can this go on, I ask you?
We're doing all we can, Mr. Maros. This is Steve Mitchell, United States government agent. He's joined the investigation.
How do you do, Mr. Mitchell? Perhaps we can get to the bottom of this soon, huh? Before I'm run out of business. So far, four of my ships I have lost. Ram, shot out of the water by this ghost.
I understand how you feel, Mr. Maros. But...
my men have become frightened. Soon they will refuse to man my ships, and then where will I be?
Have you talked with Dubeck yet?
No. No, they would not let me in to see him. They said he was not well enough to talk.
We can go in now. The doctor said it was all right.
Oh, good, good.
Well, here we are. You two go on in. I want to check with headquarters.
Dubeck. Dubeck.
Hmm? Huh? Oh, Monsieur Maros.
Yes, yes.
It is good of you to come to see me.
This is Mr. Mitchell of the American government. He will probably want to ask questions.
Hello, Dubeck.
Monsieur Mitchell, I'll of course tell you all I know, what I can remember.
Fine. The shelling took place just off Baku Island, right?
Yes, monsieur. There was heavy fog. I was alone on deck when suddenly there was explosion as the shell hit us. I was thrown into the water. I looked back, saw our boat was on fire. Then I saw something else.
The ghost ship?
It looked so big, a monster coming out of the fog at me. Then it slipped as silently, disappeared into the fog again.
You got a good look at the ship then, close up?
Close up, Monsieur Mitchell. Yes, too close. A big ship, as I said, all gray color, and...
Go on, Dubeck.
There was something about the ship, monsieur. Something that at a single glance seemed familiar. That I had seen it somewhere before. It is hard to explain. Perhaps I'd be able to remember what it was when I can think more clearly.
Sure, sure. You've had a rough time.
Monsieur Maros.
Yes, my friend.
They say I will be in the hospital for some time, unable to work. There is my wife, Monsieur Maro.
Your wife, of course, Dubeck, of course.
We do not have much money. She will worry.
I understand. You must let me take care of it. I will take care of everything, huh?
Thank you, Monsieur. Thank you.
Steve!
What is it, Jeffries?
I just got word from the Coast Patrol. Our ghost is tangled with another fishing boat.
Oh, don't tell me it was one of my boats again.
No, this fisher belonged to the Carver Company. The ghost tried to ram her down an hour ago off the Ballaback Strait, but she missed. The fisher managed to trail her. Just radioed in a position.
Good. Where is the ghost?
She's gone up into the Tanya River, and there's only one way out. We've got the ghost bottled up this time, but good.
Steve Mitchell will continue his dangerous assignment in just a moment. Did you know that you help to perform miracles? Human life itself is a miracle. Through the blood you donate and the money you give through your Red Cross, you help to preserve life. And now scientists and physicians have discovered another miracle you have a part in. Blood processed into gamma globulin for use in the prevention of paralysis in polio. To collect the blood, process it into gamma globulin for the protection of our children against the dread disease will take a lot of money. In addition, the Red Cross must continue to collect whole blood for civilian hospitals which it serves, for the Korean wounded, and for the building of a safe plasma reserve for national defense, both military and civilian. Blood gives life. Money packs and sends it. When you give through the 1953 Red Cross Fund appeal, you're helping to give life. You're helping, keeping the blood bottles filled and delivered. Give and give generously. Answer the call. Now back to Dangerous Assignment and Brian Donlevy as Steve Mitchell.
Well, at last it looks like we're getting somewhere. The report from the Cabo Company fishing boat that she had just sighted the Phantom ship is our hottest lead to date. Jeffries, Morrows, and I race to the waterfront and pile aboard one of the several patrol boats lined up for the operation. We shove off. An hour later, we're nearing the spot.
No sign of fog tonight, Steve. That ghost ship won't be able to lose herself so easily.
I hope not, Jeffries.
Isn't that the mouth of the Tenaya River just ahead?
That's right, Manos.
That's where this Cabo Company fishing boat reported the ship was headed, huh?
Yes. See, there's the fishing boat off our starboard over there.
Yeah, blinking at us.
Ship?
Still up
river. Good.
You say there's no other way out, Jeffries?
Not that I know of, old boy. All right, Captain, into the river. Only a question of time now, Steve.
Be much farther now, Steve.
Hey, this river's longer than I thought.
Yes, but around the next bend, it narrows suddenly.
That's right, Maros. That's the farthest a big ship could get.
In that case, she's got to be right around the bend.
Our gun crews are ready for her.
I approach this moment with great pleasure. Blow my fishing boats out of the water, will she? Now she'll get a taste of it herself.
Wonder why she headed up this river.
Possibly a hidden supply dump around here.
Yeah, could be. She sure wouldn't have done it if she'd known the fishing boat was tailing her.
Steady now. We're rounding the bend. Steady. Now, searchlights on.
That's it. Sweeping back and forth across. Hey.
Steve. It's impossible.
There's no ship at all.
We search along both banks of the river, but can't find any concealed channels, and finally we head back to the mouth of the river. The other patrol boats have been covering the coast on each side, but can't report anything. So back to sand again, we steam with egg on our face. We're a sad-looking outfit when we get off the patrol boat.
Well, another lead up in smoke, Steve.
Yeah.
There's a place not far from here where we can get some coffee.
Okay.
Join us, Morris?
No. I will say goodnight. Jeffries, from now on until you catch that ship, I insist on adequate protection for my fishing boats.
We do the best we can, Morris.
Your best is apparently not good enough. My charter guarantees me safe fishing. I insist upon adequate protection. Good night.
What a headache, Steve. It isn't enough this Phantom ship is supplying the guerrillas. They also have to put our fishing fleets out of existence.
Well, I guess they figure that's one sure way of staying on the loose if they blow every boat out of the water that spots them.
Quite. Well, what now, Steve?
I wonder how Dubek's doing.
The survivor from the sunken fishing boat?
Yeah. When we were there earlier, he told us there was something familiar about the Phantom, something he might be able to put his finger on when he got some of his strength back.
Why, that's right. Come on, let's drop in on him. At the end, isn't it?
Hope he's been able to remember a little more.
Steve.
From Dubek's room. Locked. Get back. Dubek, stabbed to death.
The window. Open.
Come on. We dive out the window and cover the hospital grounds, but there's no sign of the killer. He must have moved real fast. Finally, we give up and drive to Morris's house and break the news to him.
Oh, no. Dubek, dead. Now I'm ruined.
What do you mean?
Well, how do you expect me to keep even one crew together when this leaks out, let alone an entire fleet?
I know. Well, come on, Jeffrey.
Right.
Oh, Morrows.
Yes, yes.
Didn't Dubek mention having a wife?
Mrs. Dubek. Of course. She lives in the village of Lemana.
She has not heard the news?
Not that I know of.
Oh, Mr. Mitchell, I don't suppose you... No, I guess it is my duty to tell her.
I think so, Maris.
I'll drive up there right away. Oh, why didn't I stay in the Mediterranean? I had it so nice there.
I see you later.
I doubt there's much more we can do tonight, Steve.
Eh, guess not.
I'll drive you by your hotel.
Fine.
You seem preoccupied.
Oh, just thinking about something Maros said.
Oh?
About being put out of business by all this.
Well, what about it?
Maybe that's the point.
But I don't follow you.
The phantom ship steams up a river. There's only one way out, but we search the river. No phantom ship.
So?
So there's one possibility we haven't examined yet. Namely, maybe the ship never steamed up that river.
But the fishing boat reported that...
Exactly. And that fishing boat is owned by the Kaba Company.
Oh, you think they deliberately sent in a false report?
Could be. Maybe they wanted to draw us away from that storehouse we were watching up the coast so they could get a load of supplies from there.
The Kaba Company...
Look, there are two fishing fleets, Maros's and the Kaba Company. Maros has lost about four boats. How many has the Kaba Company lost?
Why, none that I know of. Matter of fact, I think they've acquired two additional ones recently.
I see.
Steve, you may have hit it right on the head. If the Carver Company is behind this business, they could be trying to kill two birds with one stone.
Sure, smuggle contraband to the guerrillas and put a rival fishing company, Maros, outfit out of business. Do they have any freighters?
I don't know, but I'm certain that Maros could tell us.
Let's go back and ask him. We turn back, and then, as we get near Maris's place, we see his car pull away.
Probably on his way to break the news to Mrs. Dubeck.
Yeah, let's pull up on him.
Wait a minute. He's not taking the road to the village where she lived.
No? In that case, maybe we'd better just tag along real quiet-like and see which road he is taking.
Right.
We douse the lights and follow Maris's car. An hour later, he turns off the main road and heads toward the coast. He parks and takes off into the jungle on foot. We tail him. Pretty soon we spot what looks like a deserted ammunition dump from the war. It's almost grown over with vines. Maros disappears inside. We ease up to it.
There's a light inside.
Yeah, we can see through this crack in the wall.
Kerosene lantern.
Brother, pretty close to that ammunition.
Send a message out to the boats.
Radio operator.
Tell them to be here before dawn. We have no...
We can radio the patrol boats from the car and have them here in time to round up the whole fleet.
Come on.
You're not leaving.
What? A guard.
Keep your hands in sight. Inside. Move!
Well, company. Mitchell and Jeffries.
Hello, Maros. Your stooge here invited us in with his gun. So you're the big boy behind all this, huh? Pretty neat. There is no phantom ship. There never was. You made up the whole deal to cover the fact you've been using your fishing boats to run supplies to the guerrillas.
That is correct, Mitchell.
One thing I don't get. Why did you sink your own boats?
Well, I had the first one scuttled because a patrol boat came close. I was afraid the cargo would be discovered. Two others weren't sunk at all. I just repainted them and put them with my other company.
Oh, so you own the Kaba Company too, huh?
Yes, and the boat Dubeck was on... I planted a time bomb because he wanted more money. He tried to blackmail me at the hospital.
So you closed his mouth with a knife. Well, I guess that's all the answers.
Stay away from that lamp. Oh, oh, wait. Oh, you
fire.
Fire!
The ammunition.
I'm getting out of here.
Go. Take the radio, man, Jeffrey. I've got an
answer. Get back, Mitchell.
Jeffrey, come on. Let's drag him out before the whole joint goes up in smoke.
Flames are almost to the ammo.
Dive into the ditch.
Are you okay, Steve?
Yeah. Another second and we wouldn't have been.
Maros is coming out of it.
Yeah.
What?
You missed the show, Maros.
The storehouse.
Yeah. Looks like you just went out of business with a bang.
Our
star, Brian Donlevy, will return in just a moment. Jane Wyman, Ray Milland, James Stewart, Olivia de Havilland, Janet Gaynor. These are only a few of the 20 former Academy Award winners who will be heard Thursday, March 19th, when NBC broadcasts the complete Academy Award presentation ceremonies. It's Hollywood's most important night of the year, the night when Academy Award Oscars will be presented to Hollywood's finest artists. Bob Hope will be master of ceremonies, and film star Paul Douglas will be the NBC radio commentator. When you listen to the Academy Awards broadcast via NBC, you'll hear the music nominated for the awards, the names of all of the actors, actresses, musicians, directors, and technicians who received this year's nominations. And then you'll be right there through the medium of radio when the Oscars are handed out by former winners of Academy Awards. It's a night that outglitters all other Hollywood opening nights, a night that you'll want to be a part of. Hear the Academy Awards on the NBC Radio Network, Thursday, March 19th.
Next week, Scandinavia. I elect myself target for tonight.
And that will be Steve Mitchell's dangerous assignment next week. Included in tonight's cast were Ramsey Hill, Paul Frees, Paul Duboff, and Eddie Fields. This is John Storm speaking. Dangerous Assignment, starring Brian Donlevy as Steve Mitchell with Herb Butterfield as the commissioner, is written by Bob Reif and Adrian John Doe and is directed by Bill Karn. Be with us again next week at the same time when Brian Donlevy, starring in the role of Steve Mitchell, will embark on another transcribed Dangerous Assignment.
From the final season of Dangerous Assignment, starring Brian Donlevy, 71 years ago, March 11th, 1953. Tomorrow, comedy on your Tuesday with an episode of The Jack Benny Show, The Great Gildersleeve, starring Willard Waterman, also You Bet Your Life, starring Groucho Marx, Jim and Marion Jordan as Fibber McGee and Molly, and of course, Lum and Abner. That's on Tuesday's Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Up next, Casey, crime photographer.
In case of enemy attack or grave national emergency, keep listening to your radio. The emergency broadcast system will immediately bring you official information and instructions. Stations will not give call letters, but will identify the area they're serving. So dial around till you find the right one in your area, and then follow the instructions given.
Now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, you're going to find out how wonderful glass is in a moment. Casey, crime photographer, starring Staats Cotsworth, sponsored by the Anchor Hawking Glass Company, originally broadcast 76 years ago, March 11th, 1948, Fog.
The Anchor Hawking Glass Corporation brings you Crime Photographer.
Ethelbert, how did you ever get that name?
I don't know. There was some argument just before my christening.
So they picked Ethelbert right out of a hat, huh?
No, my aunt was reading some novel. She found that name in it.
Well, that's a good enough name. Well, they might have given you a more famous name.
Did I hear somebody start it?
Start what?
Start to talk about famous names.
Oh. Well, what's your idea of a famous name?
Huh, that's easy, Casey. Everyone knows Anchor Hawking, the most famous name in glass. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Tony Marvin. Every week at this time, the Anchor Hawking Glass Corporation of Lancaster, Ohio, and its more than 10,000 employees bring you another adventure of Casey, crime photographer, ace cameraman who covers the crime news of a great city. Our adventure for tonight, Fog. Late afternoon, the Blue Note Cafe, and Ethelbert, the head bartender, completes preparations for the crowd of cocktail sippers that will soon come drifting in.
Walter, bring up some more...
Lemons!
Yeah, oh, hello, Casey.
Hi, Ethelbert, hi.
Just coming off a job?
Yeah.
Oh, where's Miss Williams?
At the office. She'll be here in a few minutes. Oh, this has been one of those dull, monotonous days. I'm getting pepped today.
Yeah, I kind of feel that way myself. My sister Edna says I ought to take vitamins.
Hello, Ethelbert.
Hmm? Oh, hello, Miss Williams.
Oh, Casey, wait till you hear what's just happened.
I know. Somebody's fed you a vitamin.
Huh?
What are you all pepped up about,
Edna? Oh, I just received an anonymous letter.
Anonymous letter, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Who from? Oh, one of them without any name signed to it.
Yes.
Who from, he said. What's exciting about that?
It contains a tip, a news tip, and it sounds like a big one. Here, take a look.
Well, what's it say?
Read it to him, Casey, but keep it under your hat, Ethelbert.
Well, you know me, Miss Williams.
Mm-hmm. It's typewritten on plain stationery.
Yeah, well, read it.
Says here, Dear Miss Williams, an important news story may break at the Pellhaven estate of Willis J. Baldwin tomorrow. As your society editor will know, a ball is to be held there late in the evening at which Mrs. Baldwin will wear her famous diamond necklace. If you want an exclusive front page story, arrive around 6 p.m. and say nothing to the police, the Baldwins, or anybody about this letter.
We ain't nobody.
Which the writer, who must be anonymous, urges you to destroy.
Well, isn't that something?
Something, all right, but what?
Casey, it's a tip that somebody's going to try to steal those diamonds.
That's the way it sounds to me.
To show this to City Desk, Annie?
Yeah, right after I read it. Burks assigned us to follow it up.
Well, we covered together.
Mm-hmm.
I've read about Mrs. Baldwin's diamond necklace, Casey. It's said to be worth over $1 million.
Yeah.
Casey, who do you suppose sent this letter?
Well, how should I know? What I'm wondering about, Annie, is why was it sent to you? This kind of a tip is seldom sent to a gal reporter.
Mm-hmm. I've never had one just like it before.
We're to be at the Baldwin's 50-room suburban cottage at 6 tomorrow night.
Mm-hmm. How are we going to crash into their place at dinner time?
Look, I'll tell you what. I'll phone Mrs. Baldwin and give her a yarn of some kind.
Oh, you know her?
Well, I've taken pictures of her, you know, news pictures. Have you ever met the Baldwins or anybody who's intimate with them, Annie?
Oh, I've interviewed the Count de la Fere.
Well, who's the Count de la Fere?
One of those ornamental slickers with a foreign title. Who gets around the high cost of living by being a perpetual house guest of the oh-so-rich and idle. I think he's staying with the Baldwins now.
Yeah, well, Willis J. Baldwin's supposed to be a tough, shrewd guy. He's not the type who puts up with lounge lizards.
Well, Count Raymond de la Fere may be Mrs. Baldwin's special friend.
Yeah. Well, look, I'll go over to the phone booth, put in a call for Mrs. Baldwin, Annie. See if I can make us a date. Thanks very much, Mrs. Baldwin. Yeah, we'll be there at 6. Goodbye.
What? Did you get her, Casey?
Yeah. Everything's all set for 6.
All's well. What excuse did you give her?
Well, I said we wanted to come early so I could take shots of the final preparations for the ball. Incidentally, that letter's right about one important item, Annie. She is going to wear the diamond necklace tomorrow night.
You asked
her? Well, just offhandedly. I said I'd like to take some special pictures if she wore it, and she said she meant to.
If the letter's right about that, it's probably right about everything else.
We'll see, pal. Annie, I still can't figure out, though, why that letter was sent to you.
Can't you drive just a little faster, Casey? It's after 6, and we're late.
I can't help it, Annie. I can't help it. I can't see if I try to do any speeding through this fog, we might wind up in a hospital.
Must be close to the water. Hear that foghorn?
Yeah. That's the one on McBurney's Point.
Oh. Why didn't we check the weather reports and find out we'd run into a pea soup fog, and then we could have started earlier
Stop worrying, Annie. We're at the edge of the Baldwin Estate right now.
Oh, that high wall
there? That's right, yeah. It completely surrounds the place. Some years ago, an attempt was made to kidnap Willis Baldwin, and a couple of guys are taking pot shots at him, so now he goes in for walls and armed guards.
Who took shots at him?
Oh, some guys he'd busted on the stock market. He plays rough down there, even under the SEC.
Hey, Casey, there's an armored car coming out that gate.
Yeah, that's right. I must have just delivered the diamonds.
Do we go in that gate?
Yep, after we stop and give the keeper our names.
Uh-huh.
Ah, there he is.
Uh-huh.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. I'm Casey, Morning Express. This is Miss Williams. Here's my press card.
Thank you. Okay, go ahead. Thank you.
Hello? He obviously is one of the armed guards.
Oh, yeah, there's a dozen or more in the place. Not counting Big Tim Blake, Baldwin's personal bodyguard.
This doesn't seem to me like a good place to try any robberies. I wish I could see something of the grounds, but the fog's so thick and black.
Yeah, a really slick crook may have done something you wish we had done, Annie. Checked weather warnings.
You mean a
crook... This fog would be a great help in getting away.
Oh, yeah.
Now, here's the house.
Oh, well, it's a regular castle.
Yeah.
Now, there's another guard.
Good evening.
Good evening. Miss Williams and Mr. Casey.
Yes, sir. I just got word from the gateman. May I take care of your car,
yeah,
sir?
Yeah, thanks. Come on, Annie.
Mm-hmm. The butler will announce you. He's coming now.
Yeah, I see.
Hey, Casey, I know that butler.
Yeah?
Yeah. I'm sure I do, but I can't remember where I...
Shh. Here he is.
You're the people from the Morning Express.
Yeah.
Follow me, please.
His voice is familiar, too, Casey, and he gave me a funny look. Did you notice?
Fleming? Is that Mr. Casey?
Yes, Mrs. Baldwin.
Well, I'm very glad to see you.
Mighty nice of you to let us barge in on you this early, Mrs. Baldwin.
Not at all. This, of course, is Miss Williams, the reporter you said you'd bring with you.
Yes.
How do you do, Mrs. Baldwin?
Nice to know you, my dear. Come into the library. We have something there that will interest both of you. Close the door, Fleming, and keep out that awful fog.
Yes, Mrs. Baldwin.
He's a new butler. Not very experienced. I have to remind him of everything.
Well, I've seen him somewhere.
What are we to see in your library, Mrs. Baldwin?
The necklace you want to photograph. It was brought here from the bank only a few minutes ago. My husband and a guest are standing guard over it.
It is altogether magnificent, Mr. Baldwin.
It should be. What I paid for it, Count. Oh, Helen.
Miss Williams, may I present my husband?
How do you do, Miss Williams?
Mr. Baldwin.
And le Comte de la Fere?
I believe this little newspaper lady and I have met before.
It's nice of you to remember me, Count de la Fere.
And this is Mr. Casey.
Hiya, Casey.
Privileged to know you, monsieur.
Mr. Baldwin, Count.
My wife tells me you want to take some pictures of her necklace, Casey. It's over there on the table. I was just showing it to de la Fere. In case you'd like to stick it in your pocket, Big Tim there won't let you.
Oh, Willis.
Oh, the man knows I'm only kidding, Helen.
Sure, Mr. Baldwin. How are you, Tim?
Hello, Casey.
Oh, you two know each other?
Oh, yeah. Since long before Tim went into the bodyguard business.
Back in the days when I was a cop, boss.
You give Casey an okay, Tim?
He's okay.
Oh, then we let him get real close to the necklace, eh? Guess you'll want a good look at it, too, Miss Williams. Women usually do.
Oh, simply... I've never seen anything so gorgeous, Mrs. Baldwin.
It is nice, isn't it?
Mr. Baldwin tells me, and this necklace is the greatest number of perfectly matched first water diamonds set in any single example of the jeweler's art, Miss Williams.
Oh,
and it is worth. The amount is staggering.
Any man could live high, wide, and handsome for a lifetime on what this necklace is worth, de la Fere.
So I imagine.
But he'd have to steal it or steal my wife, whom I gave it to, and neither of those things can be done while I'm around.
I'm sure it would be quite impossible.
Quite impossible.
Would you like to take your pictures now, Mr. Casey?
Yes, Mrs. Baldwin, thank you. I'm surprised there aren't detectives from your insurance company here to watch this necklace. They're usually around.
These diamonds are not insured.
What? Not insured?
Except for a few days each year, they're kept in the bank vault. And when Mrs. Baldwin wears them, as she will tonight, my own employees, like Tim here, keep them well protected.
I never take my eyes off them, boss.
Well, I'll shoot a picture of them lying here on the table.
No, go ahead. Where's that dumb new butler, Helen? 15 minutes ago, I told him to bring in cocktails.
Well, here he comes now, Willis.
Why did you take so long, Fleming?
I'm sorry, sir. Some matters came up today.
All right, you're here at last. Bring that liquor wagon over here.
There's one picture.
Serve the cocktails, Fleming.
Yes, Mrs. Baldwin.
I don't like to drink in half darkness. Why have you got all the shades drawn, Helen?
Well, you know I always draw them when there's fog, Willis. It's so dreary to look outside.
Well, then let's have something besides just a few table lamps on in here. Turn on the main lights, Fleming.
Yes, Mr. Baldwin.
I like to see the people I'm talking to. What's that?
What have you done to the lights?
I told you to turn more on, Fleming, not to switch them all off.
I haven't touched the switch, sir. I hadn't reached it. Now it's so dark, I can't
find... get some lights on in here. Tim.
Yeah? I found the switch, Willis.
There. Well, now that we can see again... What?
Mr. Baldwin, the diamonds!
They are gone.
Tim!
I was standing right here beside him, boss, but I couldn't see him.
I know who took them.
Miss Williams.
Now I know who that butler is, Casey. He's the notorious jewel thief, Chris Masters.
You're not going to rap me for this.
Stop this, bullet.
Look out, he's jumped through the window.
I'll get him.
Shoot!
He's running away, disappearing in the fog.
He's out of sight. I can't see him anymore. I'm going after him, Boss.
I'm coming with you, Tim. That man has the diamonds. Helen, give orders to close the gates and guard the wall.
I'll take care of it, Willis. Come with me, Raymond.
I'm with you, Mrs. Baldwin.
Well, everybody's gone and left us, eh?
Well, come on, Casey. Let's get in on the chase.
Oh, well, there's no hurry.
No hurry. No. A man's out there with $1 million worth of stolen diamonds, and you stay...
The guy you accused didn't get those diamonds.
Well, I tell you, I recognized him as Chris Masters. He switched off those lights.
Nobody switched off any lights. Look at the cord on his table lamp here.
Hmm? Oh, it's been cut in two.
Yeah. Interesting, isn't it? Now I know why you got that anonymous letter, Annie.
What?
The fog seems to be lifting a little. Oh, well, let's go outside and join the manhunt, huh?
Casey, will you tell me what you mean?
When we get outside, Annie, in the fog. The fog that's lifting.
You know, you hear a lot about modern industrial design with its twin ideals of beauty and usefulness. But nowhere is this better exemplified than in the creation of a new kind of dinnerware called jadeite. And it's spelled J-A-D-E-I-T-E. Jadeite is really beautiful. It has the color of fine jade and the texture of rare porcelain. But jadeite is also unbelievably strong. It resists chipping and cracking and is so heatproof you can safely put it in a hot oven. And with all these advantages, jadeite actually costs less than the most ordinary, uninspired dinnerware. For instance, a big jadeite platter costs only 25 cents in open stock, and a 35-piece dinner service for six people is priced at less than $5. Ask for jadeite at your favorite chain store, department store, hardware store, or at other stores selling chinaware and glass. A set of jadeite makes an attractive gift, and it's an easy way to replenish your own supply of dinnerware. Jadeite is the newest triumph of Anchor Hocking. The most famous name in glass.
This day covers a lot of territory, Annie. I think Chris Masters will be fairly hard to find.
Casey, I want to know why you think he didn't take those diamonds.
Okay, Annie. Well, it's because he had no chance to take them.
Well,
the person who sent you that anonymous letter saw to that.
The person
Yeah, that letter bothered me. It just wasn't right. When we got here, I recognized Masters under his butler suit and his dyed hair and phony English accent a few minutes after I saw him.
You did?
Sure I did. Yes, and I was sure he recognized me and you. He wouldn't take a chance on lifting those diamonds with us in the house, Annie.
Hmm. Go on.
Someone who was in that library a few minutes ago knew before tonight that Fleming, the butler, was really Masters, the jewel thief. And they figured correctly, I imagine, that he was planning to steal the Baldwin necklace. Well, that someone decided to get it first, to let Masters take the blame. But this someone didn't want to be the person who pointed the finger at Masters, because that wouldn't look so good. So you were brought out here to make the accusation.
The article I wrote on Masters after my interview with him several years ago was featured under my byline.
That's right. By Ann Williams.
And that meant that I'd be sure to recognize Masters. Wait a minute. He says nobody switched off those lights?
Yeah, that's right. The fuse was blown.
The fuse was blown?
Yeah. The cord on that table lamp, Annie, had been cut with a scissors or knife, causing a short circuit. And when the lights went out, Masters was the one person in the room who I'm sure wasn't near the cord, because he's the one person I was watching. It's that cut lamp cord that makes me certain somebody besides Masters was after the diamonds.
Well, if the lights were short-circuited, how could Mrs. Baldwin turn them on?
Well, she switched on the main lights, Annie, the wall and the ceiling brackets. They're on a different circuit, apparently.
Oh, well, why did Chris Masters do a run-out the moment I told who he was? That seems to prove...
Well, it only proves that whoever sent you that letter did another smart piece of figuring. Annie, didn't you mention in your story on Masters that as a jewel thief he lost his head, kind of, when things got hot and he always did a run-out?
Mm-hmm. And if I hadn't accused Masters and he hadn't run, Mr. Baldwin would have called the police and everyone in the room would have been searched.
Uh-huh. Now the thief has had a chance to get the diamonds off his person and into some
hiding place somewhere.
Well, then the someone who planned all this is either...
Count de la Fur, or whatever his name is. Big Tim Blake, or Mr. or Mrs. Baldwin.
Well, the Baldwins wouldn't steal their own diamonds,
Casey. Wait a minute, Annie. People have been known to stage phony thefts of their own property.
Well, sure, to collect insurance, but Mr. Baldwin said the necklace wasn't insured.
Yeah, that's right.
What do you think about Count de la Fair?
Well, $1 million worth of sparklers might be very attractive to a guy like him.
Baldwin seemed a little jealous of
him. Yeah, I caught that.
And you know the bodyguard, Tim Blake, sir.
Well, I don't know Tim Blake well enough to eliminate him as a suspect.
He said he'd been a cop. Why did he leave the force?
Well, for the good of the service. The commissioner figured Tim was too willing to use a gun. He shot up a couple of guys that maybe shouldn't have been shot up.
Mm. Well, be no way of finding out who really got the diamonds if he or she hasn't already hidden them.
Oh, he or she hasn't hidden them, Annie.
Well, a minute ago, you said...
I said the thief has had the chance, but he didn't take it.
Well,
you see, the person who got those diamonds, Annie, wasn't the person who planned on getting them.
Oh, what are you talking about?
Annie, when the would-be thief reached for that necklace in the dark, he or she got a great big surprise. It wasn't there.
It wasn't there? Well, how do you know?
Because I'd reached first.
You?
Yeah. Meet Raffles Casey, the $1 million bandit.
Well, what have you done with the necklace?
It's in my pocket.
In your pocket?
Sure.
Oh, Casey.
And everybody but you and me, including the would-be thief, is sure that it's in Chris Master's pocket.
Oh.
Annie... It won't surprise me if the smart would-be thief does something very foolish very soon. Well, that fog is almost gone, Annie.
Mm-hmm.
You can see pretty well now.
Yeah. Casey, all our suspects seem to be looking for Masters individually. During the past 15 minutes, we've seen the count, Big Tim and Baldwin, each of them alone.
We haven't seen Mrs. Baldwin. That means she's alone, too.
Mm. Oh, Casey, you're taking an awful chance with those diamonds in your pocket. If they were found on you, no one would believe
that
you didn't...
Yeah, they'd think the worst, all right, wouldn't they, huh? But, Annie, this is the first time I've ever had $1 million worth of anything in my pocket. It kind of makes me feel... No, no, no. It's funny. I don't feel any different than when I was honest and...
Oh. Hey, Casey.
Gunshot.
Yeah, over there.
Come on, Annie.
Okay.
Boss, I think I got him.
That's Big Tim's voice.
Yeah, I did get him, boss. Come here.
There he is. Beside those trees right there, Casey.
You got Masters, Tim?
Yeah, the thief. Oh, it's you, Casey. Hey, boss. Where's Mr. Baldwin?
I'm coming, Tim. You guys stick to your post. Don't block over here.
Masters is lying behind those evergreens.
Now, let's have a look.
Hey, you shot Masters, Tim?
Yes, Mr. Baldwin. I heard a movement amongst those trees, and then I saw a moving figure. Kept on moving after I told it to stop, so I blazed away.
I heard shooting. What has happened?
Tim here just shot our thief, Count.
That butler, Fleming.
Did you search this guy before you started shooting, Tim?
What chance would I have to search him, Casey? I
well,
just
someone
told
has
him.
Searched him. Take a look at your ex-butler, Mr. Baldwin.
Yeah, I see.
His clothes are all torn.
Yeah, all his pockets that aren't torn inside out are ripped open.
Well, I didn't search him.
You didn't shoot him either, Tim.
I didn't shoot him.
No. I can't find any bullet holes in him.
I see none.
This guy was strangled to death.
Who did it?
Maybe the moving figure you saw was the someone who did it, Tim. You fired at it from a distance and then found this fellow lying here and concluded your bullets had shot him.
Yeah, that must have been what happened.
Who did kill that man?
Count de la Fair, I have a kind of a half idea.
You have, Casey?
Yes, Mr. Baldwin.
I have more than a half idea. I just found something near Master's body that...
What'd you find, boy?
Let us see.
I found something that tells me the strangler was you, Count.
Let me go.
Count de la Fair?
You're crazy, Mr. Baldwin. Help me, this man, and let me go.
Oh, break it up, Baldwin. You got him down. Now break it up.
All right. But don't let that fellow get away, Tim.
I won't, boss.
Here's what I found beside Master's hand, Casey. This black coat button. Then I saw there was a button missing from de la Fair's dinner jacket. Look, this button I found matches the others on his coat.
You lie. That button you pulled from my coat now when you attacked me.
A jury won't see it that way when you're tried for Master's murder.
This man is mad.
Take it easy, Count. Take it easy. Why should de la Fair be tried for murder, Mr. Baldwin?
Because he killed Masters.
This dead guy was a fugitive suspected of stealing your wife's necklace. If Tim had shot him as we thought at first, you wouldn't have called Tim a murderer.
If I had choked that thief, I would be a fool to deny it, and I'm not a fool. But I was never near the man.
You deny it because of the search you made of Master's clothes. You wanted the diamonds he stole.
Search me, somebody. I have no diamonds.
You've had time to hide him someplace. Take him to the police, Tim.
Wait a minute.
You're butting into this too much,
Casey. I don't think so, Mr. Baldwin.
On the evidence of that button, you're formally accusing Count de la Fere
of killing this thief, Chris Masters, in order to hijack the stolen diamonds.
Oh, now it's Chris Masters, huh?
Huh?
When Miss Williams recognized your phony butler tonight, she mentioned his real name only once and very rapidly. You knew who your butler really was before tonight.
That's crazy. You can't prove that.
Maybe I can. Tim was a good shot. When he fired at the moving figure, he didn't miss completely. He put a hole through your coat sleeve.
Hold?
Yeah, look. Here,
right here. That's me, Tim.
Now, Casey, hold everything, Tim. Take a look at this.
Yeah, it looks like a bullet hole.
It is a bullet hole. This man tried to accuse me of what he himself has done.
You murdered Chris Masters to hijack property of your wife's that you'd meant to steal.
I'll try to prove that. You just try. Let me go.
Okay. Baldwin, you've attempted a theft tonight. You killed a man. You've tried to frame the count. When a guy like that can't be brought to book in one way, sometimes he can in another. Tim, as an ex-cop, wouldn't you say your boss was guilty if you found the stolen necklace on him?
Yeah.
It's your duty to see if he has it, Tim. All right, I'll hold him again.
I haven't those diamonds, you fool. Take the hand off my mouth.
Go through his pockets, Tim. He's given me quite a battle here. He's afraid to have you search him.
This will cost me my job, Casey.
It's your duty.
Okay, I'll do it, but... Casey...
The diamond necklace.
There you are. You did find it on him, Tim.
Oh, Casey.
This is a frame-up. A frame-up.
You and the Count take care of him, Tim.
Come on, Paul. When I'm working for the law again.
I will help you take good care of him, Tim, after what you tried to do to me.
This is a frame-up. This is a frame-up.
Well, Annie, let's go along. I'm going to get some pictures now.
Casey, you slipped that necklace in his pocket while you were struggling with him.
Yes, Annie. Just like he pulled a button off of Delafaire's coat. You know, Annie, when you can't trap a crook in any other way, one good frame deserves another.
We'll join the crowd at the Blue Note in just a moment. Will you please give me your attention for 1 minute? I have a message of importance for the millions of people in the United States who are listening to this program. Listen closely, please. You can now buy your favorite brand of beer and ale in the new one-way, no-deposit bottle. Now, let me repeat that. You can now buy your favorite brand of beer and ale in a new kind of glass bottle that requires no deposit and that never has to be returned to the store. This new bottle is light in weight and very compact. It's easy to carry home and takes up less room in your refrigerator. You pay no deposit on the new Anchor glass bottle, and you do not have to return it. Remember, it's glass. Clean and sanitary glass. For more than 100 years, Americans have preferred beer and ale in glass bottles. So I suggest that when you buy beer or ale, you demand it in the new Anchor Glass one-way, no-deposit bottles. Product of Anchor Hocking. The most famous name in glass.
Well, Baldwin confessed after the cops went to work on him, huh, Casey?
Yeah, good thing, too, Ethelbert. Naturally, I couldn't have stuck to my frame-up in court.
Baldwin needed money to pull himself out of a deep hole he got into in the stock market. That big estate, in fact, everything he had was mortgaged to the rafters. Only his wife's necklace was free and clear. He preferred to steal it rather than ask her for it.
Yeah, because he was pretty sure she wouldn't have given it to him.
Why did he try to frame that Count, whatever his name is?
Well, first to cover himself, of course, and then second, because he thought his wife was in love with a guy.
Baldwin had a big nerve to be jealous after some of the things he'd been doing.
What things?
Mostly blondes.
Yeah? Blondes?
Oh. The cops have been digging into his private life.
And found blondes, huh? Wow. To tell me more.
Well, there was a little chick named Doris.
Oh, darn, there's the bar phone. I'll be right back.
Ethelbert.
Blue Note Cafe, Ethelbert speaking.
Wow.
Huh? You'll have to speak louder. I can't understand you. Huh? What?
Casey.
What's his name?
The fog is entirely gone.
Are you in the same room?
When we came in here, I noticed the stars were out.
Yeah, I noticed that too, Annie.
Louder, please.
I can't. Spring was kind of in the air too.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's a nice night to be outside.
Yeah, it is. It's a swell night to be outside.
Oh, no.
Well, what are we doing here?
You know, we'd be crazy if we stayed here, Annie.
Oh, no.
Come on, Annie, let's go.
We're going, Casey.
Oh, mister, you got the wrong number. Tell me about them blondes. Walter, where did Casey and Miss Williams go?
Out.
Out?
Out.
Oh, well, of all the... Walter, bring up some more lemons.
Crime Photographer, starring Staats Cotsworth as Casey, is written by Alonzo Dean Cole. It is brought to you each Thursday by the Anchor Hawking Glass Corporation, makers of Fire King Oven Glass, Anchor Glass Containers, Anchor Caps and Closures, all products of Anchor Hawking, the most famous name in glass. Directed by John Dietz and is based on the fictional character of Flash Gun Casey, created by George Harmon Cox. Original music is by Archie Blyer, and the program features Miss Jan Minor as Anne and John Gibson as Ethelbert. Herman Chittison is the Blue Note pianist. The Girl Scouts are celebrating their 36th birthday this week. Your time and interest is the best birthday present they could get. If you can spare just a few hours a week, offer your services by calling your local Girl Scout office. This is Tony Marvin saying goodnight for the Anchor Hawking Glass Corporation of Lancaster, Ohio, with offices in all principal cities of the United States and Canada. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Seventy-six years ago, March 11th, 1948, Casey, crime photographer, starring Staats Cotsworth and Jan Minor, who would go on to fame as Madge, the lady who was the in the Palmolive dishwashing liquid commercials back in the day. A reminder to visit our webpage, classicradio.stream, where you can stream our shows, learn about building a classic radio collection of your own. You can contact me there, find our social media links, and if you're so inclined, you can buy me a coffee. That's at classicradio.stream. All righty, and the support is really appreciated, and we thank Doug for his support of the program and so many of you who have done that. Up next... a series we have not run a lot of episodes of. We found a few cache of them now. Lon Clark, starring as Nick Carter, Master Detective.
Civil defense is common sense. This is Fred McMurray. Home shelters can be built for as little as $100. Simple plans for building inexpensive home shelters are available free from your civil defense office. Ask for a copy of the Family Fallout Shelter booklet.
The character of Nick Carter goes back all the way to 1886. He's appeared in a variety of formats for more than, well over a century now. It was first conceived by Orman G. Smith, and it would go on. He appeared in the New York Weekly magazine, and it went on for years. Street and Smith did a number of them. There was a number of pulp fiction novels in which it was there, and Nick Carter would go on to become a radio star. The Return of Nick Carter, and then would be changed to Nick Carter, Master Detective. It aired over Mutual for a number of years, And we're going to hear an episode today of Nick Carter, Master Detective, from 79 years ago, March 11th, 1945, The Webs of Murder.
What's the matter? What is it?
It's another case for Nick Carter, Master Detective.
Yes, it's another case for that most famous of all manhunters, the detective whose ability at solving crime is unequaled in the history of detective fiction, Nick Carter, Master Detective, presented by the three great Linex home brighteners, Linex clear gloss varnish, Linex cream polish, and Linex self-polishing wax, created by Acme, America's great producer of fine Acme quality paints. Today's curious adventure,
Webs of Murder, or Nick Carter and the Mystery of the Black Widow Spiders.
In just a moment, we'll hear how Nick Carter solved the mystery of the Black Widow murders and saved the webs from getting into the hands of the enemy. But before we do, consider this. Millions of Americans have learned how easily Chemtone, the miracle wall finish, brings amazing new beauty to the home. Now, millions more are learning that floors, woodwork, and furniture can be made to look like new with the three great Linex home brighteners. Linex self-polishing wax beautifies floors with a satiny yet tough anti-skid finish that resists wear, water, and dirt. Linex cream polish cleans as it polishes, leaving no oily film on your furniture. And Linex clear gloss varnish, the durable super varnish that dries to an elastic, transparent surface, protects all wood and linoleum in your home. You'll find the three great Linex home brighteners at your hardware, paint, or department store. Your headquarters also for Chemtone, the miracle wall finish. And now for today's mysterious adventure with Nick Carter. As we begin today's story, we find Nick and Patsy in Nick's car returning to town.
Oh, gosh, Nick, I'm glad you were able to prevent that poor old lady's home from being taken away from her.
So am I, Patsy. That was a jip game if ever I saw one.
Mm-hmm.
The old lady was to the right, but I had to find the proof for her. Otherwise, she'd have been turned out in the streets with nowhere to go.
You going right back to the office?
No, not directly. I have to stop off and do an errand for Riley first.
Do an errand for Riley? Since when have you started that?
I haven't started anything, Patsy. Riley called me this morning just before you got to the office and asked me if I do this job as a special favor to him.
What do you have to do?
Well, it seems that there's a woman on Cherry Street who makes a business of supplying spider webs to the Army and Navy.
Oh?
They use them for crosshairs for engineering instruments and sighting devices for gun sights, bomb sights, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
It's only a small business, but it's pretty valuable. And mighty important, too.
Where do you come in?
Well, this woman called Riley early this morning and said that someone had tried to break into her place last night. She has a large shipment just ready to go out, and she's afraid that someone may try to keep her from delivering it.
I see.
So Riley asked me if I'd stop in on my way back and pick it up. Said he had no good man he could send for it now because of some special work the police are doing just now.
And good-natured old Nick said he would. Where do you have to take it?
To one of the naval buildings downtown. Besides being worth about $10,000, the web's very important to the service. Also, I thought you might like to see how they collect this web from the spiders. You want to come with me?
Well, I've got a dental appointment in about an hour, Nick, but I'll stop off and have a look at this spider conservatory. How long are you going to be there?
Only long enough to pick up the stuff, I expect. Unless there's some delay, you ought to get back to town. Plenty of time for your appointment with a tooth specialist.
Yes?
I'm Nick Carter. I've come to pick up the web that you want delivered to town.
Who told you to come here?
Lieutenant Riley said you wanted police protection.
That's right, I do. Would you mind identifying yourself, please?
Not at all. Would this prove my identity sufficiently?
Oh, of course. Come in, Mr. Carter.
Thank you, Miss...
Lewis, Kay Lewis. I own this business.
This is Miss Bowen, my assistant.
How do you do?
How do you do?
The web will be ready in just a few minutes. I have one more spider to take care of.
This is a new one on me, Miss Lewis. I've seen plenty of spider webs, but I never thought of saving any of them.
Well, that's a very different thing, Miss Bowen. You can't just save any old web you might find around the house. You have to go at it the right way and have the right kind of spiders.
What kind do you use? Black Widow, aren't they?
Yes. Their web is very strong and very uniform.
Black widows?
Mm-hmm.
Aren't they deadly poisonous?
Well, there's really no danger if I get bitten. A solution of Epsom salts injected into the bloodstream will counteract the poison.
It's nice to know, but I hope I never have to use it.
So do I.
Oh, look at all the jars, Nick. Is there a spider in each jar?
Not quite. We have 160 here just now. I checked up last night. My assistant, Jim Baldwin, is out in the field collecting more today.
How do you get the web, Miss Lewis?
Well, watch me. I let the spider out of the jar, and almost at once it starts to spin a web. I take the end of the web, so, and fasten it to this small wire frame. There. Then I just wind up the frame, and the web winds up as fast as the spider produces it.
I understand you had an attempted burglary here last night, Miss Lewis.
Yes, someone tried to break in the back door. We found chisel marks all around it this morning, but they were unsuccessful, or else they got scared away.
Any idea who might want to steal your stuff?
No, but I didn't want to take any chances with such an unusually large shipment as this, so I asked for police protection.
And I don't blame you. You say there are 160 spiders here, huh?
Yes, all widows.
Okay, I'm back.
In here, Jim. That's my assistant, Jim Baldwin.
Well, not much luck this time, Kay.
Oh?
I only got 11 more black widows. The woods are too dry just now.
Oh, Jim, this is Mr. Carter and Miss Bowen.
How do you do?
How do you do?
Mr. Carter is taking the shipment of web to the naval building for me to be sure it gets there.
Oh, I see. You know, I can't understand why anyone would want to steal the webs. We're the only collectors in this part of the country, and no one else could sell them without attracting attention.
Well, I know it sounds foolish,
but
Well,
I'm not criticizing you. I'm just thinking out loud, that's all.
Oh, Miss Lewis, how much longer before the web will be ready?
Oh, not long. As soon as I finish this one web, I'll pack them in those cases, and they'll be ready to go. Not over half hour at the most.
Now, I think I better get along, Nick. I can take the subway. I don't want to be late for my appointment with the dentist.
Okay, Patsy. I'll see you in the office about noon.
All right. Thanks for the demonstration, Miss Lewis.
You're very welcome.
So long.
Goodbye. I'm sorry to keep you waiting, Mr. Carter, but you can't hurry these spiders.
That's quite all right. I don't have to hurry.
Oh, Jim, get that, will you please?
Sure, I'll take it.
Now, those cases you pack the web in look like boxes of fishing tackle, don't they?
Yes. You can pack a lot of webs into a pretty small space.
It's for you, Kay. Pete Morrow.
Pete? Oh, thank you. I'll only be a moment. Excuse me, please.
Pete Morrow. Isn't he that small-time gangster who runs a garage?
Yeah, that's the one.
Sells black market tires and gasoline?
That's him.
Now, what's her connection with him?
Nothing, I guess. They've been out together a few times. Well, it's time to feed the spiders. Each one gets a fresh kill fly once a day. Watch this. Now, watch her go after it. See that?
Yes. Well, don't think I'd care to be... Oh. Feels as if 1,000 hammers were... And Baldwin, too. Had you too, huh? I wonder if... Where the web? They're gone, both cases. Great grief. Miss Lewis. Miss Lewis, are you... I'm dead. Shot right through the head. And wait. That's my gun there on the floor. But she was shot with my gun. Hey, Baldwin. Baldwin. Baldwin, wake up. Wake up.
What happened?
Baldwin, can you hear me?
Yeah. What's the matter?
Kay Lewis has been murdered.
Kay? Murdered?
Yes, shot through the head. And the web is gone, all of it.
The web gone?
Yes. Did you see the guy who slugged us?
Well, no. I looked around as you went down. I saw someone behind me, and then I got it, and got it good.
Okay, come on. Snap out of it, will you? Get on the phone and call the police.
Police?
Of course. Get in the office and call them now.
Yeah, all right. I'll call them.
I'll have a look around, see if I can find anything to tell us who's behind this. Whoever it was used my gun, wiped all the fingerprints off. Clean as a whistle now. Hello. What's this? Wasn't here before. That I'm sure of. Ticket for a parked car. Morrow's garage. Pete Morrow. That's what he phoned here just
I
before
got
we got...
They're coming right out.
Look here, Baldwin. Are you sure that was Pete Morrow on the phone a few minutes ago?
Well, sure it was. I know his voice. Why?
I just found this on the floor here. A parking ticket for Morrow's garage.
Well, probably just a coincidence. Somebody who had parked at Morrow's place did this.
You're wrong there. This is the other end of the ticket. The end held by the garage.
Yeah, so it is. So what? I know that was Morrow on the phone. Besides, he was still talking to Kay when we were slugged.
Yes, you're right there. Miss Lewis was still talking last I knew. I wonder. This ticket wasn't here before the killing. Yet it's here now. In lieu of a better clue, I think I'll take a run over to Morrow's place and see what I can get out of him.
Oh, I wish you luck, Carter.
Hey, by the way, how long have you been in business here?
About a year.
Who started the business?
Kay did.
How'd you get into it?
Well, she knew I was a zoologist, so she asked me where she could get some black widow spiders. The idea interested me, and I finally gave up what I was doing and came over here. I collected the spiders, and she collected the webs. We've been very successful.
Know anything about her past?
No, nothing. Never thought much about it before. But why all these questions, Carter?
Just want to learn what I can before I talk tomorrow.
Sorry. I don't know anything more than I've told you.
All right, Baldwin. You wait here for the police. I'll have a talk with our friend, Pete Morrow. Pete Morrow around?
Yeah, he's in the office.
Anybody with him?
No, you can go in if you want to.
Thanks, I will.
Come in.
Pete Morrow?
Yeah, that's me. What do you want with me?
I want to talk with you.
Okay, you got the floor.
And suppose you keep your hands on top of your desk while we talk.
What the...
Just sit still. Keep your hands in sight.
Hey, who are you anyway? What do you want with me?
I'm Nick Carter. As I said, I want to talk to you.
Okay, so you're Nick Carter. So what?
I just want to ask you if you know anything about this bump on the back of my head.
Bump on the... I don't know what you're talking about.
Maybe you don't, maybe you do. You know Kay Lewis?
Yeah, sure, I know her. Good-looking dame.
Been out with her?
Yeah, what's it to you?
Know what business she was in?
Sure, I knew about them spiders.
And you also knew the webs were worth a lot of money, didn't you?
Hey, what are you getting at? You trying to pin something on
me? Sit down!
Hey.
Did you telephone Kay Lewis about an hour ago?
Huh? Yeah, sure. I had a talk to her.
What about?
Why, I...
You're lying, Morrow. Now stay right where you are. I want to have a little look around this office of yours.
I don't know what you're trying to do, copper. But I'm telling you, I don't...
What are those boxes under your desk, Morrow?
Boxes?
Yes, boxes. What are they?
They're tools. Mechanics tools.
Yes? Well, suppose you shove those tools out from under your desk and let me have a look at them.
Well, there ain't nothing there, but...
Don't try reaching for your gun again. Next time, I'll aim lower. Now shove those boxes out here. Will you, Pete?
I don't see why you're so interested in them boxes. They just...
You know well enough why. There's enough spider web in those cases to send you to the chair.
To the chair?
You shouldn't have killed Kay Lewis, Maura.
I didn't kill her. I took the web, sure, but I didn't do anything to her.
You admit you stole the web?
Sure, I got the web. It wasn't my fault. That was...
Who's doing the shooting this time? Was it Nick or was it someone trying to kill Nick? Did Pete Morrow kill Kay Lewis or was it someone else? We'll see in just a moment. I know every man notices that beautiful floors add to the appearance of a room. And every woman knows that well-kept floors reflect the pride she takes in her home. Now, with Linex self-polishing wax, you can give your floors a more beautiful finish than ever without tiresome rubbing or polishing. For Linex self-polishing wax is simply wiped on, drying to a handsome, satiny finish that really wears. Because Linex self-polishing wax contains genuine Carnauba wax. When worn spots do appear, you simply renew the finish where it's needed without re-waxing the whole floor. And Linex self-polishing wax is easy to keep lovely, for surface dirt is quickly whisked away with a damp cloth. What's more, Linex self-polishing wax is the anti-slip floor finish, as the underwriters' laboratories have proved. And it's equally fine for tile, wood, or linoleum. Ask your dealer now for Linex, L-I-N-X, Linex self-polishing wax. You'll find all three great Linex home brighteners and Chemtone, the miracle wall finish, at hardware, paint, and department stores everywhere. And now back to our story. Nick had just made Pete Morrow, small-time gangster, admit that he had stolen the missing spider webs when two shots were fired in rapid succession. It's a few minutes later.
You must bear a charmed life, Nick, if neither of the two shots hit you.
Only the second one was aimed at me, Patsy. The first one went right through Pete's forehead. I dropped behind the desk, and the other one went over my head.
Do you have any idea who killed him?
Not yet. Tried to get him, but he got away.
Why would anyone want to kill Pete?
To keep him from talking too much, probably. Pete had just admitted he stole the webs and was about to tell me something else when he was shot. I imagine the killer himself was listening, and when Pete started confessing, shot him to keep him quiet.
Did you get the webs back, Nick?
Yes, both cases. They're in my car now. I'm going to take them back to the spider place. Riley should be there by now.
You walked into something when you agreed to deliver those cases, didn't you?
Apparently I did. But here's why I called you, Patsy. I want you to look into our files. Get together all the information you can find on Kay Lewis and her business. Call me at the spider place as soon as you get it. There's something very peculiar going on around here someplace.
Saw the beat of it, Nick. The way you're always around when somebody gets killed. And I suppose you know nothing about it the same as usual.
Oh, I wouldn't say I know nothing about it, Riley, but I certainly don't have the solution all ready to hand over to you. Have you made any of your usual startling discoveries yet?
None of your wise cracks, Carter. I'm doing all right.
Ah, fine, fine. And what have you found so far?
Well, we got the bullet that killed this Lewis woman, and it came from a .45. That bullet's got to identify the killer for us.
I doubt that, Riley.
And why do you doubt it?
Because I'm pretty sure the bullet was fired from my gun.
From your gun? You mean you shot her?
I mean nothing of the kind. After I was knocked out, someone stole my gun, shot Miss Lewis, and left the gun on the floor beside her.
Doggone it. That's the only real clue we had.
Well, there are other clues, Riley. Although I doubt that you would get much out of them.
Why, you...
For example, I know that Pete Morrow, small-time gangster and black market operator, stole the spider webs that are missing.
Pete Morrow's it? Hey, Sergeant! Send a couple of the boys out to pick up Pete Morrow.
That won't do any good, Riley.
Why not? Pete ought to be able to give us some dope on this.
Pete is not going to tell anybody anything anymore.
Huh?
Someone put a slug through his head while I was talking to him.
Another killing? We ain't even solved this one yet.
When you solve this one, Riley, if you do solve it, you'll have the answer to both of them. I believe the same person killed both Kay Lewis and Pete Morrow.
Did you learn anything from Pete before he was killed?
Only that he stole the webs and that someone else was back of it.
Where are the webs now?
Outside my car.
That ain't safe, Nick. Maybe the killer will be back to get them.
They'll be safe enough. I left them in charge of one of your men out there.
Oh.
Hey, where's Jim?
Who's Jim?
Kay Lewis's assistant. Jim Baldwin.
Oh, him, sure. He was here a while ago, but he said he was feeling pretty sick after finding Miss Lewis shot the way she was. So I let him go over to the drugstore for something to make him feel better.
How long has he been gone?
Only a few minutes, sir. Let me see here. Well, good gosh, it's longer than I thought. He's been gone about 3/4 of an hour. Sure, he ought to have been back here before this.
Huh. That's very interesting.
What's going on out there?
Well, this thick-headed cop of yours...
One at a time. No, Scotty, what's the trouble here?
Well, Mr. Carter asked me to keep an eye on his car so no one would bother him. When I just took a look at it, I found this fella fooling around. So I brought him in.
That's ridiculous. I didn't know it was Carter's car.
What were you doing with it?
I wasn't doing anything with it. I was on my way back from the drugstore, and as I passed the car, I just happened to glance inside. I thought I recognized the cases we used to pack the spider webs in. And I was just having a look at them to make sure when this dumb cop came up and grabbed me.
Dumb cop, did you say? Why, for...
No, guys,
that's all, Scotty. Go back and watch the car like you was told to.
Yes, Lieutenant.
Hey, Jim, have you been at the drugstore ever since Lieutenant Riley let you go?
Well, sure I have. What else would I be doing?
Is exactly what I'd like to know.
Are you insinuating
that I... I'm insinuating nothing. By the way, you said someone tried to break in here last night.
That's right.
Which door was it? That one there?
Yes. You can see the chisel marks all over the outside where they tried to break the lock.
That's just what I do want to see. I'll be right back, Riley.
Take your time. Take your time. I got nothing else to do but watch you play around here.
Shall I answer it, Lieutenant?
Why shouldn't you answer it?
Well, I didn't know now that you're in charge.
Go on and answer it.
Sure, sure.
Hello? Sure. Wait a minute. Carter, telephone for you.
Okay, thanks. Probably in my office.
Now look here, Baldwin.
Hello?
You said you got back here with them spiders you'd caught just before the killing this morning, didn't you?
That's right. The weather was bad for spiders, and I hadn't had much luck. I only got 11 spiders for 12 hours' work.
Hmm?
Well, sometimes I got as many as 35, maybe 40, in the same length of time.
Oh.
But this time, all I could find was 11. Hardly worth the trouble.
Mm-hmm.
Did I hear you say you got 11 spiders, Jim?
Yes. You saw them when I brought them in this morning.
So I did. So I did. How's your arithmetic?
Arithmetic? I don't get you.
How much is 160 and 11 added together?
Are you being funny, Carter?
Definitely not. Add 160 and 11 and see what you get.
Any fool could answer that, Nick. I know the answer myself. You get 171.
That's what I make it too, Riley.
What's this all about, Nick?
Let's count the spiders here in this room and see how many there are.
What do you want to do that for, Nick?
Just to satisfy my curiosity. Now, what do you say?
You and your curiosity. All right, all right. Let's count the things and get it done so we can get to something important.
This is important, Riley. You take that side. I'll take this.
All right. 1, 2, 3, 4... Hey,
don't move! I'll shoot if you do. Keep your hands up high.
He broke the jars and some of them spiders is loose and they're poisoned.
Just step on it, Riley. They can't bite you unless you get on them.
If the spiders don't get you, gentlemen, I will. With my little 45.
Nick, one of them is on me. He's going to bite me.
Knock it off, Riley. You're not dead yet.
Not yet, but soon. I missed you in Pete's office this morning, Carter, because I was in a hurry. But I won't miss you this time.
You mean you killed Pete Morrow?
I did, just as I'm going to kill you.
I don't think you are, Jim.
And why not?
Look behind you and you'll see.
You can't fool me that way, Carter. I'm no chump.
Oh! Good shot, Nick. I'll take care of him now.
Hey! I've been bitten. One of the spiders got me.
Oh, my fine friend. Try and get out of these.
Oh. Good work, Riley.
Quick! Get some of the Epsom salts before I die. They're in the first aid cabinet there.
You killed Kay Lewis, didn't you?
Yes, yes. Get the salts, quick.
And you killed Pete Morrow, too, didn't you?
Yes. Do something. I'm dying.
Pete stole the web as part of your deal, didn't he?
For the love of heaven, will you hurry up?
Didn't he?
Yes, yes, yes. I planned it, but he just helped me. Will you do something before I die?
Oh, yes, hurry. I'll give you the Epsom salts
now. Hurry, hurry.
I want to save you for the electric chair.
You've had quite a day.
Yes, Betsy, quite a day.
And now that everything's quiet and peaceful, suppose you give out with the missing details. Did you know Jim Baldwin was behind us when you started out?
No, not at first, Betsy. There didn't seem to be any motive for him to do it. But as soon as you told me that our files show Kay Lewis's partner and not her employee, I got suspicious.
Mm-hmm. Well, go on, tell me all about it.
All right, slave driver. Jim Baldwin knew there was a big shipment of webs going out this morning. And he wanted it for himself. So he planned everything to look as if he couldn't possibly be mixed up in it.
Uh-huh.
So he told Miss Lewis he was going out after a new batch of spiders. But instead, he came back after dark and chiseled around the lock on the door to make it look as if someone had tried to get in.
Oh.
As soon as I examined the door, I knew it was a phony attempt. Then he arranged with someone to call Miss Lewis at a certain time this morning, just as he got back in with his 11 spiders. He answered the phone himself, and told us it was Pete Morrow. Said he recognized his voice. That gave Morrow an alibi as well as himself. Then he knocked me out, and Morrow, as they'd arranged, came in and took the webs. Jim says he never planned to kill Miss Lewis, and I think that's true. When he found me there, he was afraid, as he hadn't expected any witnesses, so probably thought it would look more legitimate if she were killed. So he took my gun and shot her. Then tapped himself on the head hard enough to raise a good bump just to fool me.
Then if you hadn't found the parking ticket from Morrow's garage, you wouldn't have had any reason to suspect Morrow, would you?
No, that was a lucky break. For me, not for Morrow.
But how did Jim get away to kill Morrow? He stayed at the Spider Lab, didn't he?
Well, after Riley got there, he talked Riley into letting him go to the drugstore for some medicine.
Oh.
But instead drove to Morrow's place and got there in time to overhear our conversation. Then, being afraid Morrow was going to confess that he, Jim, was behind the deal,
Shot him.
And on his way back, he saw the webs in your car and tried to steal them again.
Right.
But, Nick, if Jim didn't go out gathering spiders, as he said he was going to do, where'd he get those 11 spiders he brought back with him?
Took them out of the stock at the lab when he was there last night trying to make the lock look as if someone had tried to break in.
Oh, then that was why you wanted to count the spiders.
Exactly, Betsy.
Oh, I get it.
Miss Lewis told us in the morning that she had 160 spiders on hand, remember?
Mm-hmm.
Well, if Jim had brought in 11 more, that would have made 171 in all.
Right.
So I wanted to count them to see how many there actually were. And when I started to do that, Jim knew the game was up because he knew we'd find only 160, which had been there before. So he tried to get rid of us by breaking several of the jars in order to let some of the Black Widows out, hoping they'd bite us.
But one bit him instead.
Yes. I saw one heading for him, so I kept talking, hoping he wouldn't notice it. Then when it did bite him, I shot his gun out of his hand.
It's an old story, isn't it? As has happened many times before, a widow caused his downfall, poor man.
In just a moment, Nick and Patsy will bring you a preview of next week's exciting case. But right now, here's a helpful hint. When there are children in your home, it's a real job to keep your furniture looking its best. Small hands leave fingerprints, small shoes leave scratches, and the youngsters demand so much of your time. So it's really wise to depend on the quick, easy shortcut to furniture beauty, Linex Cream Polish. Linex Cream Polish renews the gleaming beauty of your fine furniture. And it's so simple to use, for it cleans as it polishes, saving you half the time and energy. Yes, in one quick application, Linex Cream Polish does away with the cloudy look of dust and old polish, erases finger marks, helps conceal scratches. And Linex Cream Polish dries hard, so there's no leftover oil for dust to cling to. Ask for Linex Cream Polish at your dealers now. You'll find all three great Linex home brighteners, Linex cream polish, Linex clear gloss varnish, and Linex self-polishing wax at your nearest hardware, paint, or department store. Now, an urgent reminder. Your serviceman needs the Red Cross, needs the touch of home it provides for him wherever he may be. Help support the Red Cross overseas clubs and what they can do for that fighting man of yours. Contribute now toward the $200 million the Red Cross needs. And keep your Red Cross at his side. And now let's hear from Nick Carter himself. Well, Nicholas, what's your story about next week?
Patsy and I went to the races one afternoon just before the season closed and saw one of the most exciting races I've ever witnessed. But as the winning jockey came down the home stretch, he suddenly fell from his horse and was instantly killed.
And Nick, being a detective, born and bred, instantly smelled a murder. Nothing to go on, just one of his hunches.
Was it murder, Nick?
Even in the absence of proof, Ken, I knew it was murder. The only job was to get something concrete in the way of evidence.
Which Nick, being Nick, proceeded to do, much to the annoyance of a great many people who all tried to do something about it.
What do you call this story of yours, Nick?
Death Goes to the Post.
Or The Mystery of the Murdered Jockey.
And that's all for now. So long.
Details next week. So long, everybody.
And so long to both of you. We'll be looking forward to seeing you next week as usual. Next week at the same time, listen to another curious experience of Nick Carter, master detective, entitled
Death Goes to the Post, or Nick Carter and the Mystery of the Murdered Jockey.
Nick Carter, master detective, is featured in Street and Smith magazines. Lon Clark is starred as Nick, with Helen Choate as Patsy. Original music is played by Lou White, and the programs are written and directed by Jock McGregor. Nick Carter, Master Detective, is presented at this time and over these same stations each week by the three great Linex home brighteners, Linex clear gloss varnish, Linex cream polish, and Linex self-polishing wax, created by Acme, America's great producer of Acme fine quality paints. This is Ken Powell speaking for the thousands of Linex dealers all over America and saying so long until next week. This is Mutual.
I wonder if that Acme Products company was related to the people that the Wile E. Coyote used to buy stuff from. I just mention it. Nick Carter, Master Detective, 79 years ago, March 11th, 1945, here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Comedy Tomorrow with Jack Benny. Willard Waterman is the Great Gildersleeve, Groucho in You Bet Your Life, Fibber McGee and Molly, and Lummett and Abner. Coming up next, Vincent Price as the Saint.
A well-designed school can be more than a fine building and a place for learning. It can also protect the children, the teachers, and the whole neighborhood, too, if the architect has designed the school to serve as a community fallout shelter as well. Over 13,000 architects and engineers have been trained in fallout shielding techniques. To learn more about building fallout shelter into new schools, contact your local civil defense director.
Now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, we continue with an episode of The Saint starring Vincent Price. This episode goes back 73 years to March 11th, 1953, The Shipboard Mystery.
Adventures of the Saint, starring Vincent Price. The Saint, based on characters created by Leslie Charteris and known to millions from books, magazines, and motion pictures. The Robin Hood of modern crime now comes transcribed to radio, starring Hollywood's brilliant and talented actor Vincent Price as the Saint.
Just a moment, please. Yes?
Mr. Tempora? Mr. Simon Tempora?
And if I say yes?
Oh, I am a George.
Congratulations. What army are you dressed for?
Oh, not army uniform I wear, sir. Chauffeur. You come?
Huh?
You come now?
You want me to go somewhere with you?
You are sure you are Mr. Simon Tempora? The Saint?
If I'm not, my old grandmother shouldn't have lied to me all these years.
Then you come.
Where?
Did you not receive the call, sir?
Even the most casual eavesdropper would have to admit it doesn't appear so. What call?
Employer say, George, go to this number and get Mr. Tempora. Employer say, he calls, so when I arrive, you know, you come. No call, sir?
No call. Who is your employer?
Mr. Orlando Button. Him old man. He very afraid.
Orlando Button. Art collector? Button galleries?
Employer say, much of trouble coming. You come help?
Oh, what sort of trouble?
We go now, yes?
You go now, yes. My neck and I recently came to an understanding.
Oh, your neck, sir?
My neck. I promised not to stick it out again until I at least knew why it was going to be chopped at, and it, in turn, agreed to be a little more tolerant of starched collars. I am going to bed.
Oh, no. You are coming.
You know, with one swift gesture, you have given me 6 good reasons why I should go with you. Or does that revolver hold 8 bullets? You sure this is a home?
Oh, yes. Home of my employer, Mr. Orlando Button.
Add a couple of ticket windows, scatter around a few timetables, and could easily pass for the home of the super chief.
Employer awaits you in the study, Mr. Tempora. You come this way, please.
Yes. Now, look, would it be too much to ask you to stop waving that gun under my nose?
You come.
I come.
Now, you wait.
I wait.
Sir! 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 Mr. Barton, I have brought Mr. Tempera, sir.
Oh, yes. Thank you, George. I must have dozed off. Mr. Tempera, it was good of you to come, but I...
Not half as good as it was of George to bring me. He is very persuasive.
Eh?
Mr. Tempera, say no come. I invite him at the point of a pistol. You no call him, sir.
No. I fell asleep. That will be all, George.
Yes, thank you. Yes, yes sir.
I'm sorry George had to resort to melodrama, Mr. Templar. Look, you'll forgive me, I'm sure. It's all a mistake.
What's all a mistake?
This incident. I never should have sent for you. My nerves. I'm a victim of my own imagination.
Remarkable.
Eh?
Here you are, trembling, yet scarcely 2 minutes ago, according to you, you were in your study there napping.
But what...
There's fear in that trembling, Mr. Button, and on your face, too. You're scared witless. Scared people don't doze.
Please, I beg of you, go at once. Forget that you've been here.
That was a long ride across town with your chauffeur's gun in my ribs, sir. Long and unpleasant.
But I didn't tell George to use a gun.
We can talk in your study.
No, you mustn't go in there, you...
Oh.
You shouldn't have done that. I tried to keep him out of here. I knew you didn't want him to see the... Why are you pointing that gun at me? What are you going to do?
Mr. Tempera. Mr. Tempera. Oh, Mr. Tempera. Here. I am giving you brandy.
Oh, that's good brandy. Wake me up some more.
You are to being all right, sir?
As soon as the canaries stop holding choir practice in my head.
Oh, so sorry. I give too much brandy.
Where's Mr. Button?
He gone.
Gone where?
Oh, no, Seagull. I go to room. Time passes. I think maybe now employee want me to drive you home again. I come here to study, finding you on floor. Employer gone, pictures gone.
Pictures? What pictures?
One that arrived today. Sailor bring crate.
Oh, well, what sort of pictures were they?
Where the... Western picture, same Western man. Look all right to me. But they make Mr. Button very angry.
Oh, and then he told you to fetch me?
Oh, no, not right away. Shorter time later. After phone call.
Phone call?
Employer call number. Speak. You get the information, write something on a paper pad. Then send me get you.
The pad? Where is it?
On the desk. Here. I give it to you.
Oh, thank you. Nothing on it.
Maybe he tear a writing page off.
George, look, take your finger and dip it in the fireplace for me, will you?
Dip it? Oh, too much brandy, too much.
Go on now. Please do as I say. Get some ashes on your hand.
Ashes?
Yes, in the fireplace.
Oh, yes, sir. Fingers are all properly dirty with the ashes?
Now rub it on this page of the pad, hmm? Lightly, gently.
Here, got enough, sir. Magic.
Western magic, known only to those few hardy adventurers who have dared to visit the forbidden city of Brooklyn.
What will the coming forth on a pad?
A picture of anime Wong.
Holy mackerel.
Look now, rub the ashes in a little harder, huh? There, that's it.
But it's words. No, Pikachu. Words that were on former page, torn off.
If Mr. Motto should ever need an assistant. That's enough now. Look, give it to me. S-T-I... Stiano. You know Mr. Stiano, George?
Not knowing so.
Stiano. S-S-T-U... No, Tuscany. The S.S. Tuscany.
Oh, sounding like steamboat.
Second thought, maybe Mr. Motto ought to be your assistant. Goodbye, George.
Oh, you go.
I go.
I come.
You stay.
You go find him, Broyer?
Yeah.
Why?
Look, I like you, George. That's why. I don't want you to lose your job, so I... Oh. That's a funny place to put a chair.
Your chair belong over here. Oh, Mr. Tempera, you say I am to losing job? Why?
We have a quaint saying in this country, George. Chauffeur lose job if employer lose life.
Who's that on deck? Who is it? Speak up.
It's me, if that means anything.
Muller, huh? Hey, you're late. I expected you. Hey, what is this?
You ain't Muller.
Name's Templar.
All right, so the name's Templar. What are you doing aboard my ship?
Looking.
You a customs man?
You the captain?
Third officer. Captain went ashore. I'm in charge. Look, fella, you boys from customs already went over this vessel 3 times since we docked this morning.
3 times, eh? It's the usual procedure, isn't it?
3 times as usual, and each time so thorough the ship is practically dismantled? What goes, pal?
Hey, you tell me.
I don't know what you boys are looking for, mister, but I'll tell you here now, it ain't on board the Tuscany. This is an honest ship.
Yeah, and I'm the captain of the Pinafore. You got a man named Stiano on board?
Look, mister, Stiano's a good guy. One of the best men on this ship. He works hard, no complaints. He's loyal, efficient, a good all-around man. That's Stiano.
Oh, you know him pretty well.
Know him? I'm him.
Well, I'm glad to meet a good, loyal, efficient, uncomplaining, all-around man. You know a man named Button?
No. You say Button?
Button, like in what one is sometimes told to do with one's lip. Button.
Like in Button Galleries, Button?
Yeah.
I know about his art gallery, that's all.
Oh, what about it?
We hauled cargo for him this voyage. A crate we picked up in Genoa. That's in Italy.
Yeah, a crate filled with paintings, valuable and rare.
Yeah, I seen them paintings. If they're valuable, then we're both the captain of the Pinafore.
Oh, bad, eh?
All I can say is phooey. What smog fails to do to the human eye looking at these pictures does.
How many?
7.
Huh. They were sent ashore?
Yeah. Look, all I know is we're loading cargo in Genoa. A guy comes on with this here crate. He gives me a song and dance about taking extra special care of this valuable art so it don't get banged around like cargo sometimes does.
That's all he asked of you?
That, and also to deliver it after it cleared through customs.
Deliver it? Where?
To the guy it's consigned to, Dr. Weber, at the Button Art Galleries. To nobody else, he says, just this here Dr. Weber, and I shall be handsomely rewarded.
Well, where are you?
I'll let you know when Miller gets back. Hope you found the art gallery still open.
Well, I'll tell you right now, he didn't.
No? Then what did he do with...
I'm inclined to think he brought it to the one man he shouldn't have brought it to, Orlando Button.
Oh, and this guy in Italy says, make sure nobody gets it but this Dr. Weber. How about that for luck? A lousy mistake is going to cost me my handsome reward.
You're getting it light, pal. That same mistake may cost Mr. Button his life.
Hey, Kesa.
Yeah. I want to make sure it was you who just come off the ship. I'm kind of glad it's you, sucker.
Yeah, you know, I'm kind of glad to see you. Let's see how good you are without the gun, you sucker.
My arm.
Say, don't worry about it. When I finish tearing it off, I promise you I'll give it back to you.
My arm. Please.
Come on now. What ill wind brought you out of retirement, Kasek?
No temper in my kind of work. When a guy says he's retired, he's either trying to kid the cops or kid himself.
You mean there's always another hoodlum who'd force you back into it, eh? Now, let's have some talk, Kasek.
Let go of the arm first.
Let loose the talk first.
I got nothing.
I'll loosen your tongue with a little history.
Josh.
When I first knew you, you worked for Scarelli as his trigger. Till he was deported a couple of years back.
My, but you're full of news. What do you want from me, Saint?
Who hired you to squeeze the trigger on me?
Nobody has to hire me to gun you down, Saint. With me, that's the labor of love. I... Oh, my arm, you're breaking.
Turn him loose.
Hey, Kasek, either there's someone behind you, you've developed a decided talent for ventriloquism.
He's no ventriloquist, and I'm no dummy.
Who are you?
I'm just a man with a gun, and the gun is in your back. Turn him loose.
Yes, that's it.
He's loose.
Oh, pal, you sure came along when I most needed.
Beat it.
Huh?
The boss wants you. Get right over there.
Oh, you gonna handle the sucker?
I'll handle him. You beat it.
Okay, pal. Okay.
All right, turn around, Templar. Carefully, very carefully. Good. You did that very nicely.
Yeah, I've been taking dancing lessons.
It's too bad someone doesn't sell lessons in how to mind one's own business. From now on, you're keeping your nose out of this affair. It doesn't concern you. Clear?
Like tapioca. Yeah, I get shanghaied by a fast-drawing Oriental with a gun. I get my skull bashed so hard my brains are threatening to move out of the neighborhood.
I get very sincerely menaced by a beady-eyed bandit with intent to kill, and now you come along and tell me this affair doesn't concern me?
All this really happened?
If I were dreaming, it wouldn't be about those kind of things.
Okay. So what's the angle to all this mishmash?
I can only make wild guesses. None of my ideas have had their final fittings yet. So suppose you tell me, what angle are you wearing today?
Like I told you, Saint, me, I'm just a man with a gun.
Yeah, so you said. And, the paintings?
Paintings?
Yeah, the crate of paintings, 7 in number, that arrived today from Italy for the Button Galleries.
Now I'm dreaming. You mean you're chasing paintings?
You mean you're not chasing paintings?
Friend, either you're deliberately throwing me a curve or we're not even playing in the same ball game. No, I'm not chasing paintings. What I'm chasing is just a little more dangerous.
You wouldn't say that if you were wearing my aching head.
I'll be seeing you, art lover.
Yeah, it's inevitable. And if you should run across an old party named Orlando Button before I do, will you please do something to help him stay alive?
Now, this is the last pipe dream I'll listen to. Why can't this old party manage to stay alive on his own efforts?
And this is one of the wild guesses I was telling you about. The last time I saw Button, he was a very frightened man. The kind of fright that only comes to a man who expects he's going to be killed.
If I see him, I'll do what I can to stop him from being afraid.
And that statement can be taken two ways. And in the light of the fact that it was pronounced by a fellow who hobnobs with Killer Kasach.
Goodbye, Saint. And if I were you, I'd worry about trying to keep myself alive.
Good morning.
I believe the door is plainly marked private, isn't it?
One finds it difficult to believe all one reads these days. You know, it's nice.
What's nice?
That they don't hang all the works of art in this gallery on the walls. Some of it sits in a low-cut dress behind a sign that says assistant to the director.
You wish to see someone?
Actually, my wish is to remain here with you, but I'd never get to see Dr. Weber that way.
You have an appointment with Dr. Weber?
No.
Well, I'm afraid he can't see you then. He's very busy.
And then I'll see Mr. Button.
Mr. Button?
This is the Button Art Galleries, isn't it?
You will have to make an appointment with Mr. Button at his home. He rarely comes down to the galleries anymore.
And then I'll see Dr. Weber after all.
You not only find it difficult to believe all you read, but all you hear as well. Dr. Weber never sees anyone without an...
Oh, it is you, Mr. Tempera.
Oh, hello, George.
You find employer?
No, George.
Gentleman is a friend of yours, George?
Oh, very good friend. Mr. Simon Tempera, the saint, greater detective... makes words appear on paper with ashes. Very clever.
Oh, it's nothing really, George.
A detective? Something wrong?
Employer missing, Miss Arthur.
What?
Oh, he's mysterious. Crate come last night by sailor. Employer and I, we open. Employer get angry like he praises. Send me quick to drugstore. Then I come back.
He sent you to the drugstore?
Huh. Look here, what's this all about?
About a crate of paintings from Genoa for Dr. Weber.
Paintings? We weren't expecting anything from Italy.
Perhaps Dr. Weber was.
I most certainly would have known if the director was expecting a shipment. And what's all this about Mr. Button? I wish you'd explain...
Let's go see Dr. Weber. Maybe he likes mystery stories, too.
Very well, Mr. Templer. This way.
Thank you.
Oh, Miss Arthur. I go Paris car now, yes?
My car? Oh, no, George, you don't have to.
What is a Wednesday? Paris your car each Wednesday. That is why I come here.
Well, you can pass it by this week, George. I haven't used my car much since the last time you gave it a bath and a polish.
Okay, very well. I skip this week.
Through this door, Mr. Templer.
Oh, Lola, I'd like you to catalog that new... Oh, we have a visitor.
This is Simon Templer, Dr. Weber.
How do you do?
How do you do, sir?
Seems we have a mystery on our hands, Doctor.
A mystery? Splendid. It was beginning to get a trifle dull around here. Won't you sit down, please?
Thank you.
There's nothing like a little mystery to brighten things up a bit, is there?
Especially if you're one of those people who enjoys going to funerals, Doctor.
There's someone who's...
And let's just say that someone, when last seen, was terrified. And let's also say that that someone hasn't been seen since.
But who?
Mr. Button. According to George, he's been missing since last night.
I see. Mr. Templer, am I to understand that just because Mr. Button wasn't home last night, you are assuming that he's been murdered?
Well, that is more or less the condensed version, yes.
I believe the little verse goes like this. Don't make tragedies out of trifles. Don't shoot butterflies with rifles.
It's just as foolish to make a trifle out of what might well be a tragedy Perhaps I should give you the full-length version now, huh?
Perhaps you should, Mr. Templer.
A freighter arrived from Italy yesterday, the Tuscany from Genoa. It carried a small crate consigned to you, Dr. Weber, at the gallery here.
But I received no crate. What was
paintings,
in it?
Paintings, paintings, Doctor. And from what Stiano tells me, extremely bad paintings. But where are they, Doctor? Let's let these pictures speak for themselves.
Where are they? I never heard of them until this moment. I wasn't even in town yesterday.
You weren't?
I was in Chicago, attending a fraternity convention.
There was no crate of paintings delivered here to the gallery yesterday, Mr. Templer, I assure you.
Oh, they weren't delivered to the gallery, Miss Arthur. The seaman who carried the crate in Stiano's place found the gallery closed when he arrived, so he did the next best thing, he thought.
The next best thing?
Yes, he had no way of knowing, of course, that old Mr. Button had more or less retired from business, leaving Dr. Weber in charge of his gallery. And so rather than lug the crate all the way back to the ship, he brought it over to the Button residence.
Well?
Well, Mr. Button opened the thing up, curious to see what sort of stuff his gallery was buying these days, I suppose, and probably wished he was dead. I'm afraid his wish was granted all too soon.
But why would anyone take the trouble to ship us bad paintings?
That's what I wondered for a while, too. And that's what Button must have wondered, but not for long. He tumbled onto it practically at once.
Onto what, Mr. Templer?
You're aware, of course, of the National Treasures Act, or whatever they call it in Italy, which prevents the export of great Italian works of art?
Of course, we're aware of it. The Italian government has had it in force for years. They're perfectly right in not wanting their great works of art scattered throughout the world when it rightfully belongs in Italy.
But I still don't understand.
The seven paintings were overpaintings.
Overpainting?
Yes, surely you've heard of the technique of painting over an oil painting with gouache, with a water-soluble paint. On the surface, these pictures look like something not even a lumber company calendar would be caught dead with. Underneath, as Mr. Button found when George came back from the drugstore with materials to remove the paint, they found masterpieces by master artists of the Renaissance.
What?
You're sure?
Yes, I'm sure. Several dozen of Italy's treasures have been missing ever since the war. The customs men tell me the Italian government had a tip that some had recently been shipped to New York. How or on what ship, no one knew.
But, Mr. Button, what did he do when he...
Well, being an honest man with a reputation of many years as a reputable art dealer, he was shocked. He sent his chauffeur to fetch me. When I got there, he told me he'd changed his mind. I can assume that Button had his mind changed for him at the point of a gun.
Speaking of points of guns, Sailor, what do you think of the point of this one?
Hello, Kasek. How's your arm?
It's sore, Saint. Very sore. But not as sore as your head is going to be when I throw some lead in it.
What is this?
That's exactly what the boss wants to know. What is this? Okay, boss, you come in now.
Hello, Saint.
Scarelli.
You got a good memory for faces, Saint. It's been a lot of years.
Who could ever forget a face like yours, Scarelli, if it could win an ugly contest anywhere?
The way this guy talks, Kazak, a guy would think you're holding an invisible gun.
Doesn't make any difference that he can't see it, boss. He'll feel it as good as anybody.
I demand to know the meaning of this intrusion.
You're in charge of this joint.
I am Dr. Weber, the director.
And the dam?
Miss Arthur is my assistant.
You do all right by yourself, Fatso. Maybe after we knock off the Saint and Fatso here, we'll keep her around a little, eh, Kazak?
You're the boss.
What brings you back to this country, Scarelli? The crime wave became just a ripple when you were deported.
I'm moving back in, Saint. Bigger than ever. But first, I got to clear something up.
Huh? What sort of something?
Except for you people and a few of my boys, nobody knows Scarelli smuggled himself back in on the Tuscany. You people ain't going to be around long enough to tell a fly about it. So I want to know something.
Oh, why don't you try asking?
I am asking. I have Kazak here watching that ship day and night to see if anyone is wise to anything. To see if the federal guys are maybe heard I come in on her and are retracing.
And they are, huh?
That's what you're going to tell me, Saint. Kazak tells me he sees you snooping aboard the Tuscany. He sees lots of other guys, too. Guys with that cop look about them.
Well, they are a kind of cop at that, Scarelli.
They know Scarelli was smuggled in on that boat? They looking for me, Saint?
Well, these particular cops are customs inspectors, Scarelli. They're looking for pictures.
Pictures?
Yeah, painting.
Oh, well, that's good news. You hear that, Kazak? They're not looking for Scarelli. They don't know I'm back yet.
Let's get rid of these suckers, then, boss. They got mouths.
Yeah. Start operating, Kazak. You're the doctor.
Save the Saint for last.
All right, drop it, Kazak. Kazak, get it! I said drop it!
All right.
Everybody all right?
Who are you, Dick Tracy?
I've already told you, Templar. I'm just a man with a gun.
That gun wouldn't happen to be federal property, would it?
It would. And now you're going to ask how come a federal agent lets a mug like Kazak loose after he's been shooting his gun off at a private citizen.
Yeah, I know how come. If I'd gone through with my intention of breaking off Mr. Kazak's arm, he'd have led you to a hospital instead of where you wanted him to lead you, huh? To Scarelli.
Right, Mr. Templar. Come on, boys.
Don't push
me. Let's get away from this smart guy and be careful with those hands.
Now, what was it you were saying before about things getting a trifle dull around here, Dr. Weber?
This is a rather unusual morning, Mr. Templar.
And the crime wave in your office isn't over yet. We're back to playing button-button.
Mr. Templar, I'd prefer it, and so would Dr. Weber, if you put your cards on the table all at once instead of one at a time. We've had enough suspense for one morning. Are you accusing Dr. Weber of...
How tall are you, Doctor?
Well, I'm almost 6 feet.
And you, Miss Arthur?
Now, really, Mr. Templar, I...
How tall?
About 5 feet.
Doctor, you wouldn't ever wear high heels, would you? High heels that left an impression on the leather upholstery of a chair that had been moved alongside of a doorway.
I don't follow you.
Miss Arthur does. She anticipated my wish to go into Button's library last night. Naturally, that wouldn't do at all. The paintings were there, and a couple of them already had the overpaint removed. Correct, Miss Arthur?
You're insane.
That rap across the skull you gave me is probably what made me insane. Being a rather little girl for a headbanger, you needed height, huh? So just before I entered the library, where you'd had Button under a gun before my arrival, you moved a chair. So you had height, and so when I walked in, I went out.
Well, I suppose one should really humor him, Dr. Weber. And then what did I do, Mr. Templar?
You removed both the paintings and Mr. Button. You probably killed Mr. Button somewhere along the line.
Of course, you can prove all this. You can tell me, or the police, shall we say, exactly where Mr. Button's body lies, where the paintings are, and...
Unfortunately, no.
Well, then just as unfortunately, Mr. Templar, you have no case. Without the paintings found in my possession, without Mr. Button's body...
Pardon, interruption, please.
We're rather busy at the moment, George, please.
Oh, we'll not take a moment. Miss Arthur, you are to making a mistake.
Oh, please, George, we're having a conference. Would you mind leaving?
Arthur, come all the way downtown to wash and polish car. You say car no dirty, not need bath, not need polish.
George, will you please go now?
But Miss is mistaken. Just see car in parking lot.
Some other time, George.
Car very dirty. Car need wash, polish most fine. I go do so, yes?
No.
Of course you go do so, George. And while you're at it, take a look in the trunk compartment.
No.
Trunk compartment? What find in trunk compartment, Mr. Tempera?
Employer, George.
Oh, employer in trunk?
No, no. I didn't plan to kill him. I didn't plan to kill him.
I go look in that trunk compartment.
Never mind, George. Go call the police instead.
Oh, yes, Mr. Tempera. I go call.
And George.
Sir?
If Mr. Moto should ever need an assistant, I'll be very happy to give you a reference.
You have been listening to another transcribed adventure of The Saint, the Robin Hood of modern crime. Now here is our star, Vincent Price.
Ladies and gentlemen, in tonight's cast you heard Mary Shipp as Lola and Charlie Lung as George. Ted DeCorsia was Scarelli, Larry Dobkin, Kazak. Fred Shields played Nash and Ted Osborne, Dr. Weber. Barney Phillips was Stiano. This is Vincent Price inviting you to join us again next week at the same time for another exciting adventure of The Saint. Good night.
Saint was written by Michael Cramoy. The Saint, based on characters created by Leslie Charteris, is produced by James L. Saphir and directed by Helen Mack. Vincent Price is soon to be seen co-starring with Errol Flynn and Micheline Prell in William Marshall's production of Bloodline. All you Saint fans will be glad to know that the Saint comic books are on sale at all newsstands. Three chimes mean good times on NBC. For something new about the Army, hear The Phil Regan Show, next over most of these NBC stations. Coming from a different service base every week, Phil Regan brings you songs and fun and brings prizes to talented GIs. It's an exciting newcomer to your Sunday Chime lineup on NBC. So hear it next, The Phil Regan Show. And later today, following The Phil Regan Show, hear Mr. and Mrs. Blanding on NBC.
Leslie Charteris's character of the Saint was published in a number of books between 1928 and 1963. Other authors collaborated with him until 1983, and two additional works without his participation published in 1997. The Saint on Radio ran on NBC, CBS, and Mutual, beginning in October 1945 and concluding later in the year we're listening to here, October 14th, 1951. Alrighty, you're listening to Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Visit our webpage, classicradio.stream, to help support the program. Coming up and learn and contact us there as well. Coming up next, The New Adventures of Sherlock Holmes.
Trained people are needed to meet disasters. To fill this need, the United States Office of Civil Defense, in cooperation with the United States Office of Education and local school systems, is offering a 12-hour course called Personal and Family Survival. The course includes discussions on the effects of radioactive fallout, how to plan for and live in fallout shelters, and what to do after a nuclear attack. To learn more about personal and family survival, consult your local civil defense director.
And we wrap up this Monday edition of Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox with an episode of The New Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, a Mutual production starring Basil Rathbone and Nigel Bruce. This goes back 78 years to March 11th, 1946.
Petri Wine brings you Basil Rathbone and Nigel Bruce in The New Adventures of Sherlock Holmes. The Petri family, the family that took time to bring you good wine, invite you to listen to Dr. Watson tell us another exciting adventure he shared with his old friend, that master detective, Sherlock Holmes. Oh, and say, I'd like to tell you about something myself. I'd like to tell you about the wine that more Americans prefer than any other wine. That wine is port. And if you want to know why port is such a favorite, just pour yourself a glass of wonderful Petri California port. Look at that Petri port. Look at its glowing, deep red color. And sample that aroma. It'll remind you of a walk through a dew-covered vineyard. And now taste that Petri Port. Boy, you've got something. Petri Port is one of the most delicious wines ever poured from a bottle. Right then and there, Petri Port will become your favorite wine. I'm confident of that. And I'm sure you'll want to serve Petri Port to your friends, too. After dinner or any time they drop in for a visit. And remember, you can serve Petri Port proudly, because those letters, P-E-T-R-I, spell the proudest name in the history of American wines. Petri. Petri Wine. And now I'm sure our good friend Dr. Watson's ready for us. Let's go in and join him.
Ah, there you are, Mr. Bartell.
Good evening. Excuse me, Dr. Watson. I didn't know that you had company.
Shut the door, my boy, and come in and join us. Let me introduce you, Mr. Bartell. This is my friend, Mrs. Campbell.
How do you do, Mrs. Campbell?
How do you do, Mr. Bartell?
Mrs. Campbell is a very old friend of mine from England, and when she called on me today, I persuaded her to stay and have dinner and then join us in this little session of storytelling. You see, Mr. Bartell, she's really what you might call the star of the Sherlock Holmes adventure that I'm going to tell you tonight.
Oh, come now, Dr. Watson. I actually played a very small part in the story. In any case, I was much too young at the time to know what was really going on.
Say, this is a great idea, Doctor. One of the characters out of your fabulous past here in California in 1946 and helps tell her own story.
Oh, no, Mr. Bartell. I'm no storyteller. That's the doctor's department. I'll just listen.
No, my dear. I'll set the scene, but you must ring up the curtain, as it were. In any case, my memory isn't too clear on some of the early points in connection with the case. You will have to help me out.
Oh, but you're talking to millions of listeners on the radio. I'd be terrified to speak over the air.
We're on the air now, Mrs. Campbell.
Oh, we're not, are we? Oh, dear.
No. Don't worry, Cynthia. If they're kind enough to listen to me week after week, I'm sure they'll be delighted to hear you. And now to get on with the story. The title, The Adventure of the Living Doll. The setting, the Sussex Downs, near the bee farm to which Sherlock Holmes retired. The period, 1910. And now, Cynthia, my dear, the curtain's going up, and the first scene belongs to you. Supposing you set it for us.
Well, I'll try. We were living on the Sussex Downs also, Mr. Bartell, at that time. My name was then Cynthia Browning. My father, Arthur Browning, had been dead for some years, but my mother kept up the estate with a manager, a Mr. Hugh Tanner. I was away at school most of the year, of course, but the happiest times of my childhood were spent during those long summer months in Sussex. I lived in a small world, knowing only a few people and loving all of them, or almost all. First of all, there was Mother herself. She was the most beautiful woman in the world, and the sweetest. I remember she gave me a puppy on my 12th birthday. His name was Dusty, and he was so sweet. I talked to Mother about him one day. I must have sounded terribly young.
Mommy, darling, I do love Dusty very, very much. He's a lovely puppy, and you gave him to me.
You love him, Cynthia. I know that. But I've been feeding him. That's your job, darling. It's good for grown-up people to have responsibility.
Oh, Mommy, I'll feed him. Of course I will. I'll feed him so full, he'll burst.
Then there was the estate manager, Hugh Tanner. Such a pleasant man, and so willing to tell a 12-year-old all the things that a 12-year-old has to know or die.
But, Mr. Tanner, why did you have to shoot the horse? He'd only broken his leg.
Cynthia, horses aren't like human beings. Their legs won't mend. Now think of a horse that couldn't brisk and run and gallop across the downs. We're actually being kind to him. Honest we are, Cynthia.
And then there was Frank King, the painter who lived on the downs. He taught me to open my eyes and really see things.
No, Cynthia. That sunset isn't red. It's gold and rust. And the water, child, look at it. It's almost rose in this light. Rose flecked with cobwebs of eggshell blue. Cynthia, darling, a sunset's never just one color. Do try and remember that, won't you?
And then there was Mr. Pound from the city. I gathered that he was terribly rich and he wanted to marry Mother. But he certainly didn't understand little girls.
Cynthia, I'm going to give you half a crown for being a very good little girl. Now, tell me, what will you do with it?
I'll buy something for Mommy.
Oh, no, my dear. This is your own money. You put it in the savings account at the post office, and it'll make more money for you. Always remember, my dear, take care of the pennies, and the pounds will take care of themselves.
Then there was the wonderful wise woman who knew all the things that aren't in books.
Always remember, my bunny, that it's good luck to touch the hump of a hunchback. But the curse of Beelzebub himself will be upon ye if ye look at a sliver of silver moon through the glass.
And then, the strangest and most wonderful of them all was the lean, middle-aged man with a sharp face and the bee net, whom I met one day on the downs.
Good afternoon, young lady.
Good afternoon. I'm Cynthia Browning.
My name is Holmes. Sherlock Holmes.
Why are you carrying that net? You looking for butterflies?
Oh, no, Cynthia. I'm a bee farmer.
Bee farmer? Oh, that sounds funny. How do you farm bees?
Well, come over to my place one day and I'll show you. I say, that's a beautiful doll you're carrying.
Isn't a doll. It's my mascot. It was given to me by Frank King, the painter. He made it for me. He made it to look as much like me as possible. I call her me.
It's a remarkable likeness.
See the hair? That's clippings off my hair. And the nails? Those are clippings from my own nails. She's really me. And I love her.
Your own nails and hair? And the doll is an exact replica of you? I don't like that, Cynthia. Remember, my dear, my name, will you? It's Sherlock Holmes, and I live at the bee farm, and if anything unusual happens, come to me at once.
Of course, Dr. Watson. I'll confess that first meeting with Sherlock Holmes rather frightened me.
You didn't understand why he was so worried about the doll, eh?
No, but I remembered what he said about coming to him if anything unusual happened.
And I'm sure that unusual something did happen.
Yes, Mr. Bartell, and within a very few days. But at this point, I think Dr. Watson should take over the story. It's where he and Mr. Holmes really entered into
it. Oh, very well. As I mentioned earlier, Mr. Bartell, I was staying with Holmes. Late in the afternoon, as I remember, that you ran over to the bee farm where I first met you, Cynthia. A few moments before you arrived, Holmes and I, each of us with a cup of tea in our hands, were seated on the veranda, gazing out across the downs, and discussing the mutability of human affairs.
It's strange, Watson, that after a lifetime devoted to the more flamboyant aspects of everyday life, that now, in what is the fast approaching twilight of my days, I find such peace and companionship in the exact and predictable behavior of bees. I wonder what Moriarty would have thought.
Oh, you talking as if you're an old dodder of 90. You say what you like, but I don't think that you'll ever really be happy in retirement. You miss the danger, the excitement of the chase, the public acclaim.
What are you talking about? Yes, my work was never for the public. What did the public, the great unobservant public, who could hardly tell a weaver by his tooth or a typesetter by his left thumb, care about the finer shades of analysis or deduction? In any case, Watson, I chose a happy time to sink into oblivion. In comparatively recent years, the criminal seems to have lost all his originality and enterprise. My own little practice, when I gave it up, seemed to be in danger of developing into an agency for recovering lost lead pencils or giving advice to young ladies from boarding schools.
Oh, talking of young ladies, who's this little girl running up your driveway?
Oh, great Scott, it's little Cynthia, Cynthia Browning.
Oh, and who's she?
Oh, a charming young neighbor of mine. Hello, Cynthia.
Hello, Mr. Holmes.
You've come to see how I farm bees, haven't you?
No, Mr. Holmes. You told me to come to you. Something unusual happened. It has. Something that's frightened me.
Well, now, sit down, my dear. This is my old friend, Dr. Watson.
Oh, how do you do, Cynthia?
How do you do?
Ah, Cynthia, dear, what has frightened you?
It's my mascot. My me. Look, somebody stabbed her through the heart.
Great Scott, a doll that's an exact replica of her. With a penknife thrust into it. Good gracious me.
When did you find your mascot like this?
Just after tea. Mummy had some gentlemen calling on her. And afterwards I went up to my room and found poor me on the bed. I remembered what you told me about anything unusual. And so I came over here as fast as I could.
Yes, I'm glad that you did, Cynthia.
But did you tell your mother where you'd gone with her?
No, I didn't. She was still talking to the gentleman.
Well, she'll worry about you when she discovers your disappearance.
No, don't worry, Watson. I shall go over and talk to her at once. Now, Cynthia, my dear.
Yes, Mr. Holmes?
Who were the gentlemen calling on your mother?
Well, there was Mr. Tanner.
Yes.
He's the man who looks after the estate for Mummy.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. King, the painter.
Mr. King is the man who made this doll, eh? Now, who else was there?
Mr. Pound. He's a businessman from London that's staying with Mummy.
Mm. And they were all present in your house when you found the mascot lying on the bed.
Yes, Mr. Holmes.
Mm. Watson, old chap.
Yes, sir?
I'm going over to see Cynthia's mother at once. I want Cynthia to stay here with you. Guard her, old chap, as you would your life. Mrs. Browning, I know I must seem like an intrusive neighbor, but possibly you've heard of me. My name is Holmes, Sherlock Holmes.
Well, who hasn't heard of the famous Sherlock Holmes? Please sit down, won't you?
Thank you. Your guests have left?
Yes, but how did you know I had guests? I know you're a great detective.
Your charming little daughter, Cynthia, came over to see me half an hour ago. She told me.
So that's where she went. Did she come back with you?
No, Mrs. Browning. I felt it safer that she remain at my place for a while. My friend, Dr. Watson, will look after her. I'm afraid she may be in danger.
In danger? Mr. Holmes, what makes you say that?
You know your daughter's doll, the one fashioned in her own likeness and with her own hair and nails?
Of course. Frank King made it for her.
While you were at tea this afternoon, your daughter found the doll lying on her bed with a penknife stuck to its heart.
That's very peculiar. But I don't see that she should be in any danger because of it, Mr. Holmes.
Mrs. Browning, certain practitioners of magic believe that if a doll-like effigy is made of a human being and the effigy is then mutilated, that a similar fate will befall the living original.
But, Mr. Holmes, that's black magic. You can't possibly believe in it.
Not in the results of stabbing a doll, Mrs. Browning, but Well, it's possible that someone is trying to kill your daughter.
To kill Cynthia? Oh, no.
It may be more than a possibility, I'm afraid. And when these magical means fail, they will turn to more direct methods.
But who could possibly want her death?
You,
You have not remarried, Mrs. Browning?
No, I feel it my duty to devote my life to Arthur's child, Cynthia.
Yes, then anyone wishing to marry you might feel that Cynthia stood in the way.
But that's absurd.
But logical, Mrs. Browning. Do you mind if I ask you a very personal question?
With Cynthia's safety at stake, you may ask any question.
Are any of the three men who were present at tea this afternoon desirous of marrying you?
Well, I...
Please be completely honest, Mrs. Browning.
At different times, they've all asked me to marry them, yes.
And you won't contemplate marriage because of your dead husband's child, hmm? Tell me, Mrs. Browning, have you seen this penknife before? It was the one found stuck through the doll's heart.
I don't think I've ever seen it before.
One final question. Would anyone among Cynthia's acquaintances have a knowledge of the practice of magic?
Well, the old woman that Cynthia called the wise woman might.
Oh, who might she be?
A strange creature that lives in some hovel on the downs near here. Mm-hmm. She brews weird concoctions with herbs, love filters, and all that sort of thing.
I'd be a suitable companion for your daughter, Mrs. Browning.
I know it, Mr. Holmes. I've told Cynthia over and over again that she mustn't stray off and see the old woman. But you know how disobedient children are at her age. I'm sure she's been over there recently.
I'd like to talk to this woman. Where does she live?
I don't know exactly, but Frank can take you there. He used her as a model.
Frank King, the painter?
Yes, he lives in the village.
Mm. Then I shall call on him at once and persuade him to accompany me. We must find that wise woman, and I hope save your child from magic. Magic and possible murder. Much further, Mr. King.
Only a few more yards, Mr. Holmes. A little cottage is just behind the trees there. It's a pretty broken-down place. Poor old girl has only a few pennies to her name, I imagine.
Mrs. Browning was telling me that you used this old woman as a model.
Yes, she was a fascinating subject. I painted her as she was mixing up some devil's concoction of herbs and spices. I had her standing over a smoking cauldron with the firelight playing on her. It was quite effective.
Yes, it must have been. The subject of witchcraft appeals to you, Mr. King?
Well, I don't know anything about it. It was just that she was such a wonderful subject for a painter.
Mm.
Here we are.
I'll knock on the door. I think we'll take the liberty of going in, shall we?
I don't see why not.
What is it? Listen. Came from that room. Someone is here. Come on.
Look at her. Look at her head. Poor devil.
Yes, she's still alive. She isn't long for this world. Can you hear me? Here, let me lift you up a little. Can you understand what I'm saying? Tell me, who was it that did this to you?
She's too far gone to speak.
Got a piece of paper and a pencil?
Yes. Wait a minute. Here you are.
Thanks. Now, can you write the name of the man who did this to you?
She's pushing the pencil away. I don't suppose she knows how to write. She's trying to show you something, Mr. Holmes. She's trying to crawl over to the wall.
Yes. Here, let me help you. This will be a hiding place of some kind.
Look. She's taking a brick out of the wall.
What is it? Great Scott. Money. A veritable jackdaw's nest of pennies. And small silver. And at least a dozen golden sovereigns. That must be the money.
Look! She's picking out one of the silver coins. She's trying to give it to you.
A sixpence, but what? Oh, poor woman, she's dead. Just as she was trying to tell me something.
I can't understand it. Golden sovereigns in this hovel, and she was showing you a silver sixpence as she died. Mr. Holmes, what are you going to do?
First, check on the young girl's safety. Meanwhile, I should like you to go back to my mother's. Assemble the other two men who were present at tea time this afternoon and keep them there until I arrive. I shan't be long.
But the police?
I shall summon them, Mr. King, when I have the murderer to offer them. And I'm convinced that that will be before the sun sets tonight.
We'll hear the rest of Dr. Watson's story in just a second. Time enough for me to mention another wonderful Petri wine. Petri California Muscatel. If you like that subtle muscat flavor, who doesn't, you really like Petri Muscatel. Petri Muscatel is a clear golden wine that is just as much a hit with the ladies as Petri Port is with the men. But I don't mean by that only the ladies like Petri Muscatel. In fact, if you want to be sure to please everybody, get both Petri Port and Petri Muscatel. In other words, don't buy one, buy two. But do be sure you always buy Petri. Now back to Dr. Watson and his guest tonight, Mrs. Campbell, who played a most important part in the story herself.
Oh, not nearly as important a part as that played by Mr. Holmes and Dr. Watson.
Well, Dr. Watson, what happened when Sherlock Holmes rejoined you at the bee farm?
Well, first of all, he made sure that the little girl was safe. Then he told me of finding the dead woman and of his theories as to the killing. I can almost hear him now, Mr. Bartell, as he said...
Watson, someone wanted the little girl out of the way because they knew the mother would never marry while the child was alive.
And that someone persuaded the old woman to do the job for him, I suppose.
Undoubtedly. And she, believing in the powers of black magic, mutilated the doll, firmly convinced that in so doing she was destroying the young girl it was fashioned after.
And then, I suppose, when the potential murderer discovered the woman was merely indulging in stupid folklore, he killed her, realizing she was only a hindrance to him, and with her knowledge of the plan... A dangerous hindrance.
Exactly, my dear fellow. But how do you suppose we account for the hoard of money? Golden sovereigns, don't forget, that we found in the hovel.
Well, no doubt it was a sum that she was already being paid for the murder that she was going to commit. Mm.
As she died, she tried to give me the clue to her murderer by selecting certain coin. Now, in her possession, she had gold, silver, and copper. She chose a silver coin. And yet I can't see its significance, I must confess.
Well, at the moment, possibly not. And yet, before the evening's over, I bet you that...
What did you say, Watson?
I said, before the evening's over, I bet you...
Thank you, old fellow. That's the clue. You bet me.
What on earth are you talking about, Holmes? I was just saying...
You've just given me the answer to the whole problem, Watson.
Huh?
I'm much obliged to you. Stay here, will you, old chap? And look after Cynthia a little while longer. Within a very short time, I shall have her intended destroyer under lock and key.
Mr. Holmes, I'm glad you've come. I've had the greatest difficulty in persuading these three gentlemen that their presence was necessary.
Within a few minutes, Mrs. Browning, two of them will be entirely free to leave if they want to.
Mr. Holmes, I think it'd be a good idea to tell everyone what happened.
Yes, Mr. Pound,
Holmes,
I think
it'd be a good idea to tell everyone what happened.
Yes, how do you do, Mr. Pound?
How do you do, Mr. Holmes? Look here. If there's some scandal down
here... Oh, there is, Mr. Pound.
Then I want my name kept out of it. You hear? I have a seat on the London Stock Exchange.
Oh, very comfortable for you.
Yes.
And the other gentleman, by the process of elimination, must be Mr. Hugh Tanner, the manager of your estate, Mrs. Browning.
Yes, I'm Hugh Tanner. And now, Mr. Holmes, supposing you tell us what this is all about... I'm a straightforward man, and all this mystery is rather aggravating. Something has happened. Something that concerns us all. What is it?
Murder.
Murder?
What? Murder? Good Lord, who's been murdered?
An old woman who lived in the village. Your daughter, Mrs. Browning, referred to her as the wise woman. Mr. King and I found her tonight in a cottage on the downs, beaten to death. Murdered.
Why, that's shocking, but... What's it got to do with us?
I'll explain, Mr. Pound. Each one of you, I believe, would like to marry Mrs. Browning. Her daughter, Cynthia, is an obstacle to such a marriage. One of you decided to remove that obstacle and engage the wise woman to carry out the plan. Finding the woman clumsy and ineffective, you decided that she was a dangerous witness, and so you murdered her. Fortunately, the poor woman, as she was dying, gave me the clue to her murderer.
But how did she do that, Mr. Holmes? I thought you said that she died without speaking.
She did, Mrs. Browning, but she gave me the clue nonetheless, though I was shockingly slow in spotting it.
Well, what was the clue?
Let's stop being mysterious and come out into the open.
You were with me, Mr. King. As she died, I shall let you tell them.
Well, she was dying, unable to speak when Mr. Holmes asked who had attacked her. She couldn't write, but she showed him a hoard of copper and silver coins... And a dozen golden sovereigns.
Sovereigns in a hovel like that? Oh, I see. She meant her murderer was the man who had paid her.
And with all that ill-gotten wealth, she died clutching a silver sixpence.
And you still don't see who the murderer is? Come along, gentlemen. You should know it as well as you know your own names. Now, Mr. King mentioned that there were a dozen sovereigns. Whose name does a sovereign suggest?
Sovereign? King! You, Frank King, were the murderer.
Oh, that's ridiculous. The old woman wasn't exactly a mastermind. Why should she be so indirect? And how much is a sovereign worth? A pound. And your name, my friend, with a seat on the London Stock Exchange, is Pound.
Oh, this is absolutely absurd. I can prove that I've never even met the woman.
Well, what is the answer, Mr. Holmes? I'm sure that you know it.
The answer is obvious, Mrs. Browning, though I'm ashamed to say that a chance remark of Dr. Watson's gave me the clue.
Oh, now look here. Stop beating about the bush, Holmes. What is the answer?
A very simple one, Mr. Pound. With 12 golden sovereigns at hand, sovereigns that would suggest either the name of King or Pound, what coin did the dying woman select?
A sixpence.
Exactly. A humble silver sixpence. And what is the common slang word for a sixpence?
A tanner.
Precisely. Which tells us that you, Mr. Hugh Tanner, killed the wise lady.
Try and prove it. That's all. Just try and prove it.
Holmes, what happened?
I found the murderer, old chap, thanks to you.
What do you mean, thanks to me?
Well, I was thinking of a sixpence, the coin the dead woman clutched in her hand, as a sixpence. When you said, I bet you, I thought of the much-used expression, betcha tanner. That gave me the clue to the whole business. The dying woman was obviously trying to indicate that Hugh Tanner was her murderer.
He confessed, you say, before the police arrived.
Yes, after Frank King, the artist, had started to give him something of the thrashing he deserved. Oh, I take no particular pride in the case, Watson. Without your chance remark, I might easily have overlooked this obvious clue that the dying woman gave me. As I've said before, old chap, I should not attempt to emerge from my retirement. Yes, 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 yes. It's obvious that my reflexes are shockingly slow.
Rubbish. The police would never have solved it.
Oh, my dear Watson, when you compare me with the police, I realize that my retirement should be permanent. By the way, where is Cynthia?
Well, I arranged with your housekeeper for her to have an early supper. Some kippers, a poached egg or two, a piece of that treacle tart we had last night, and a pot of tea.
Oh, for a 12-year-old girl, my dear Watson. This is an occasion when I might accuse you of being a potential murderer.
Oh, come now, Holmes, you know perfectly well.
Here she comes now. Hello, Cynthia. Did you enjoy your supper?
It was lovely. Thank you, Mr. Holmes. Is everything all right? Can I go home now?
Yes, Cynthia. Everything's all right.
Tell me, my dear, did you ask Mr. King to make that mascot for you?
Yes, Mr. Holmes. The wise woman told me it would bring me luck.
Oh, yes, I thought so.
Mr. Holmes, will everything be just like before?
No, not quite, Cynthia. Mr. Tanner and the wise woman have gone away. You won't see them again.
Oh, dear.
But you have new friends here, haven't you?
Yes, and nice ones.
Remember that, Cynthia. We'll always be your friends.
I will, Dr. Watson. I like you both so much.
Ah, I'm glad. And tell me, Cynthia, do you like Mr. King, the artist?
Oh, yes. Almost as much as I used to like my daddy.
Uh-huh.
He's like my daddy, a little.
Oh, I'm glad to hear you say that, Cynthia. Tell your mother the same thing, will you? I think it might change a peculiarly foolish notion of hers.
Well, Dr. Watson and Mrs. Campbell... That was a really different kind of story. I'm sure glad you were here tonight, Mrs. Campbell. Tell me, has Dr. Watson changed much since you last saw him?
Well, yes. I think he's grown handsomer.
And what about Mrs. Campbell, Doctor? Has she changed?
Well, she's more grown up than the last time I saw her, but she hasn't changed much in one respect.
What's that, Doctor?
Your appetite, my dear.
Oh.
I remember how Holmes was amazed at the amount you ate when you were a child, but you certainly ate just as heartily at dinner this evening.
Well, that was your fault, Doctor. Your dinner was too good.
Oh, Cynthia, don't talk about the wine.
Well, why shouldn't I talk about the wine? It was wonderful.
Sure it was. It was Petri wine, that's why.
You see? Now you got him started.
And, Mrs. Campbell, Petri wine is always good wine. That's because the Petri family has been making wine for generations. Ever since long ago when they started the Petri business, winemaking has been an art with the Petri family. It's a tradition, a heritage that they've handed on down from father to son, from father to son. Believe me, when it comes to turning luscious, sun-ripened California grapes into fragrant, delicious wine, well, you can bet your last dollar that the Petri family really knows how. No matter what type wine you prefer, for any occasion, you just can't miss with a Petri wine. because Petri took time to bring you good wine. Well, Dr. Watson, what new Sherlock Holmes adventure are you planning to tell us next week?
Well, as next week has St. Patrick's Day is only about 6 days away, Mr. Bartell, I thought next week that I'd tell you a rather unusual story that took place in Ireland at the turn of the century. It concerns the famous ceremony of kissing the Blarney Stone, St. Patrick's Night Revel, and an old Irish ballad that led directly to one of the most devilish murders that Sherlock Holmes and I ever encountered.
Tonight's Sherlock Holmes adventure was written by Dennis Green and Anthony Boucher and was suggested by an incident in the Sir Arthur Conan Doyle story, The Adventure of the Copper Beeches. Music is by Dean Fossler. Mr. Rathbone appears through the courtesy of Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer. Mr. Bruce through the courtesy of Universal Pictures, where they are now starring in the Sherlock Holmes series. You can read about the stars of our broadcast in the April issue of Everybody's Digest. The Petri Wine Company of San Francisco, California, invites you to tune in again next week, same time, same station. Sherlock Holmes comes to you from our Hollywood studios. This is Harry Bartell saying goodnight for the Petri family. For a solid hour of exciting mystery dramas, listen every Monday on most of these same stations at 8 o'clock to Michael Shane, followed immediately by Sherlock Holmes. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.
Seventy-eight years ago, March 11th, 1946, The New Adventures of Sherlock Holmes. Thank you for tuning in to Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, our podcast available everywhere, as we've told you, and we hope you will visit our webpage, classicradio.stream. Tomorrow, comedy with Jack Benny, The Great Gildersleeve, You Bet Your Life, Fibber McGee and Molly, and Lum and Abner. Have yourself a great Monday.